Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Guns of the South by Harry Turtledove. Narrated by Paul Costanzo.
1. Headquarters, January 20th, 1864. Mr. President, I have delayed replying to your letter of the 4th until the time arrived for the execution of the attempt on New Bern. I regret very much that the boats on the News in Roanoke are not completed. With their aid, I think success would be certain. Without them, though the place may be captured, the fruits of the expedition will be lessened, and our maintenance of the command of the waters in North Carolina uncertain. Robert E. Lee paused to dip his pen once more in the inkwell. Despite flannel shirt, uniform coat, and heavy winter boots, he shivered a little. The headquarters tent was cold. The winter had been harsh, and showed no signs of growing any milder. New England weather, he thought, and wondered why God had chosen to visit it upon his Virginia. With a small sigh, he bent over the folding table once more to detail for President Davis the arrangements he had made to send General Hoke's brigade down into North Carolina for the attack on New Bern. He had but small hope the attack would succeed. The president had ordered it, and his duty was to carry out his orders as best he could. Even without the boats, the plan he had devised was not actually a bad one, and President Davis reckoned the matter urgent. In view of the opinion expressed in your letter, I would go to North Carolina myself, but I consider my presence here always necessary, especially now when there is such a struggle to keep the army fed and clothed. He shook his head. Keeping the Army of Northern Virginia fed and clothed was a never-ending struggle. His men were making their own shoes now, when they could get the leather, which was not often. The ration was down to 3/4 of a pound of meat a day, along with little salt, sugar, coffee, or rather chicory and burnt grain, and lard. Bread, rice, corn. They trickled up the Virginia Central and the Orange and Alexandria Railroad every so often, but not nearly often enough. He would have to cut the daily allowance again, if more did not arrive soon. President Davis, however, was as aware of all that as Lee could make him. To hash it over once more would only seem like carping. Lee resumed. General Early is still in the... A gun cracked, quite close to the tent. Soldier's instinct pulled Lee's head up. Then he smiled and laughed at himself. One of his staff officers, most likely, shooting at a possum or a squirrel. He hoped the young man scored a hit. But no sooner had the smile appeared than it vanished. The report of the gun sounded odd. It had been an abrupt bark, not a pistol shot, or the deeper boom of an Enfield rifle musket. Maybe it was a captured federal weapon. The gun cracked again, and again, and again. Each report came closer to the one before than two heartbeats were to each other. A federal weapon indeed, Lee thought. One of those fancy repeaters their cavalry liked so well. The fusillade went on and on. He frowned at the waste of precious cartridges. No southern armory could easily duplicate them. He frowned once more, this time in puzzlement, when silence fell. He had automatically kept count of the number of rounds fired. No northern rifle, he knew, was a 30 shooter. He turned his mind back to the letter to President Davis. Valley, he wrote. Then gunfire rang out again. An unbelievably rapid stutter of shots, altogether too quick to count, and altogether unlike anything he had ever heard. He took off his glasses and set down the pen. Then he put on a hat and got up to see what was going on. At the tent fly, Lee almost collided with one of his aides de camp, who was hurrying in as he tried to leave. The younger man came to attention.
"I beg your pardon, sir." "Quite all right, Major Taylor. Will this by any chance have something to do with the unusual gun I heard fired just now?"
"Yes, sir."
Walter Taylor seemed to be holding on to military discipline with both hands. He was, Lee reminded himself, only 25 or so, the youngest of all the staff officers. Now he drew out a sheet of paper, which he handed to Lee.
"Sir, before you actually see the gun in action, as I just have, here is a communication from Colonel Gorgas in Richmond concerning it."
"In matters concerning ordnance of any sort, no view could be more pertinent than that of Colonel Gorgas," Lee agreed.
He drew out his reading glasses once more, set them on the bridge of his nose. "Bureau of Ordnance, Richmond, January 17th, 1864. General Lee, I have the honor to present to you with this letter Mr. Andries Rhoodie of Remington, North Carolina, who has demonstrated in my presence a new rifle, which I believe may prove to be of the most significant benefit conceivable to our soldiers. As he expressed the desire of making your acquaintance, and as the Army of Northern Virginia will again, it is likely, face hard fighting in the months ahead, I send him on to you that you may judge both him and his remarkable weapon for yourself. I remain your most obedient servant, Josiah Gorgas, Colonel." Lee folded the letter, handed it back to Taylor. As he returned his glasses to their pocket, he said,
"Very well, Major. I was curious before. Now I find my curiosity doubled. Take me to Mr. Rhoodie, was it?"
"Yes, sir. He's around behind the tents here, if you will come with me."
Breath smoking in the chilly air, Lee followed his aide-de-camp. He was not surprised to see the flaps from the other three tents that made up his headquarters were open. Anyone who had heard that gunfire would want to learn what had made it. Sure enough, the rest of his officers were gathered round the big man who did not wear Confederate gray. The big man did not wear the yellow-brown that was the true color of most home-dyed uniforms, either, nor the black of the general run of civilian clothes. Lee had never seen an outfit like the one he had on. His coat and trousers were of mottled green and brown, so that he almost seemed to disappear against dirt and brush and bare-branched trees. A similarly mottled cap had flaps to keep his ears warm. Seeing Lee approach, the staff officers saluted. He returned the courtesy. Major Taylor stepped ahead.
"General Lee, gentlemen, this is Mr. Andries Rhoodie. Mr. Rhoodie, here is General Lee, who you may well recognize, as well as my colleagues Majors Venable and Marshall. I am pleased to meet all you gentlemen, especially the famous General Lee," Rhoodie said.
"You are much too kind, sir," Lee murmured politely.
"By no means," Rhoodie said. "I would be proud to shake your hand."
He held out his own. As they shook, Lee tried to take the stranger's measure. He spoke like an educated man, but not like a Carolinian. His accent sounded more nearly British, though it also held a faint guttural undertone. His odd clothes aside, Rhoodie did not look like a Carolinian either. His face was too square, his features too heavy. That heaviness made him seem almost indecently well-fleshed to Lee, who was used to the lean, hungry men of the Army of Northern Virginia. But Rudy's bearing was erect and manly, his hand clasp firm and strong. His gray eyes met Lee's without wavering. Somewhere in his past, Lee was suddenly convinced he had been a soldier. Those were marksmen's eyes. By the wrinkles at their corners, and by the white hairs that showed in his bushy reddish mustache, Rhoodie had to be nearing 40. But the years had only toughened him. Lee said,
Colonel Gorgas gives you an excellent character, sir. You and your rifle both. Will you show it to me? In a moment, if I may,
Rhoodie answered, which surprised Lee. In his experience, most inventors were wildly eager to show off their brain children. Rhoodie went on.
First, sir, I would like to ask you a question, which I hope you'll be kind enough to answer frankly. Sir, you are presumptuous, Charles Marshall said.
The wan winter sun glinted from the lenses of his spectacles and turned his normally animated face into something stern and a little inhuman. Lee held up a hand.
Let him ask what he would, Major. You need not forejudge his intentions.
He glanced toward Rhoodie, nodding for him to continue. He had to look up to meet the stranger's eye, which was unusual, for he was nearly 6 feet tall himself. But Rhoodie overtopped him by 3 or 4 inches.
I thank you for your patience with me, he said, now in that not quite British accent. Tell me this, then. What do you make of the Confederacy's chances for the coming year's campaign, and for the war as a whole? To be or not to be, that is the question, Marshall murmured. I hope our prospects are somewhat better than poor Hamlet's, Major, Lee said.
His staff officers smiled. Rhoodie, though, simply waited. Lee paused to marshal his thoughts.
Sir, since I have but so briefly had the honor of your acquaintance, I hope you will forgive me for clinging to what may be plainly seen by any man with some knowledge and some wit. That is, our enemies are superior to us in numbers, resources, and the means and appliances for carrying on the war. If those people, is common euphemism for the Federals, use their advantages vigorously, we can but counterpoise to them the courage of our soldiers and our confidence in heaven's judgment of the justice of our cause. Those have sufficed thus far. God willing, they shall continue to do so.
Who said God is for the big battalions? Rhoodie asked.
Voltaire, wasn't it?
Charles Venable said. He had been a professor of mathematics before the war and was widely read.
A freethinker if ever there was one, Marshall added disapprovingly. Oh, indeed, Rhoodie said, but far from a fool. When you are weaker than your foes, should you not take the best advantage of what you do have? That is but plain sense, Lee said. No one could disagree.
Now Rhoodie smiled, or his mouth did. The expression stopped just short of his eyes.
Thank you, General Lee. You have just given much of my sales talk for me. Have I? Yes, sir, you have. You see, my rifle will let you conserve your most precious resource of all, your men.
Walter Taylor, who had seen the gun in action, sucked in a long, deep breath.
It could be so, he said quietly.
I await the demonstration, Mr. Rhoodie, Lee said. You will have it.
Rhoodie unslung the weapon. Lee had already noted it was of carbine length, stubby next to an infantry musket. Because it was so short, its socket bayonet seemed the longer. Rhoodie reached over his shoulder into his haversack. That was made of mottled cloth, like his trousers and coat. It looked to be of finer manufacture than even a Union man carried. Most of Lee's soldiers made do with a rolled-up blanket. The tall stranger produced a curved metal object, perhaps 8 inches long and 1.5 or 2 inches wide. He clicked it into place in front of the carbine's trigger.
This is the magazine, he said. When it's full, it holds 30 rounds. In fine, the rifle now has bullets in it, Taylor said. As all of you will no doubt have noticed, it is a breech loader.
The other aides nodded. Lee kept his own counsel. With a rasping sound followed by a sharp metallic click, Rhoodie drew back a shiny steel lever on the right side of the rifle.
The first round from each magazine must be chambered manually, he said.
What about the others?
Venable whispered to Taylor.
You'll see, Taylor whispered back.
Rhoodie reached into the haversack again. This time, He drew out some folded papers. He unfolded one of them. It proved to be a target, a cutout roughly approximating the shape of a man's head and body. He turned to Lee's aides.
Will you gentlemen please put these up at different ranges out to, say, 400 or 500 yards?
With pleasure, Taylor said promptly. I've seen how fast your rifle can shoot. I'd like to learn how accurate it is.
He took some of the targets. Rhoodie handed the rest to the other aides. They stuck low-hanging branches through some, leaned others against bushes, both in the upright position and sideways.
Shall I have them straighten those, sir?
Lee asked, pointing.
They will make your shooting more difficult.
Never mind, Rhoodie answered. Soldiers don't always stand up, either.
Lee nodded. The stranger did not lack for confidence. When the aides were through, a ragged column of 30 targets straggled southeast toward Orange Court House, a couple of miles off. The knot of tents that was Lee's headquarters lay on a steep hillside, well away from encamped troops or any other human habitations. The young men laughed and joked as they came back to Rhoodie and Lee.
There's General McClellan, Charles Marshall said,
stabbing a thumb in the direction of the nearest target.
Give him what he deserves.
The others took up the cry.
There's General Burnside, General Hooker, General Meade, Hancock, Warren, Stoneman, Howard. There's Honest Abe. Give him his deserts, by God.
Lee turned to Rhoodie.
At your convenience, sir.
The aides fell silent at once.
One of your men might want to look at a watch, Rhoodie said.
I will, sir.
Charles Venable drew one from his waistcoat pocket.
Shall I give you a mark at which to begin?
Rhoodie nodded. Venable held the watch close to his face so he could see the second hand crawling around its tiny separate dial.
Now!
The rifle leaped to the big stranger's shoulder. He squeezed the trigger. Crack! A brass cartridge case flipped up into the air. It glittered in the sun as it fell. Crack! Another cartridge case. Crack! Another. This was the same sort of quick firing as that which had interrupted Lee's letter to President Davis. Rhoodie paused once for a moment.
Adjusting the sights, he explained.
He was shooting again as soon as the last word left his mouth. Finally, the rifle clicked harmlessly instead of blasting out another round. Charles Venable looked up.
30 aimed shots, 32 seconds, most impressive.
He looked from the rifle to Rhoodie, back again.
30 shots, he repeated, half to himself. Where is the smoke from 30 shots? By God!
Walter Taylor sounded astonished, both at the lack of smoke and at himself.
Why didn't I notice that before?
Lee had also failed to notice it. 30 closely spaced shots should have left this Andries Rhoodie in the middle of a young fog bank. Instead, only a few hazy wisps of smoke floated from the breech and muzzle of his rifle.
How do you achieve this, sir? He asked.
The charge in my cartridges is not your ordinary black powder, Rhoodie said,
which told Lee nothing not already obvious. The big man went on.
If your officers will bring in the targets, we can see how I did.
Taylor, Venable, and Marshall went out to retrieve the paper men. They laid them on the ground, walked along the row looking for bullet holes. Lee walked with them, quiet and thoughtful. When he had examined all the targets, he turned back to Rhoodie.
28 out of 30, I make it to be, he said. This appears to be a fine weapon, sir, and without a doubt, very fine shooting. 32 seconds, Venable said.
He whistled softly.
May I show you one thing more? Rhoodie said.
Without waiting for a reply, he loosened the catch that held the magazine in place below the rifle, stuck the curved metal container into a coat pocket. Then he pulled another one out of his haversack and clicked it into position. The operation took only a moment to complete.
Another 30 shots?
Lee asked.
Another 30 shots,
Rhoodie agreed. He drew back the shiny handle with the snick Lee had heard before.
Now I am ready to fire again. But what if the Americans... We are Americans, sir,
Lee broke in.
Sorry, the Yankees, I mean. What if the Yankees are too close for aimed fire?
Below the handle was a small metal lever. Rhoodie clicked it down so that, instead of being parallel to the handle's track, its front end pointed more nearly toward the ground. He turned away from Lee and his staff officers.
This is what?
The rifle roared. Flame spurted from its muzzle. Cartridges flew out of it in a glittering stream. The silence that followed the shooting came hard and abrupt as a blow. Into it, Lee asked.
Major Venable, did you time that?
No, sir,
Venable said.
I'm sorry, sir. Never mind. It was quite rapid enough,
Rhoodie said.
Except at close range or into big crowds. Full automatic fire isn't nearly as effective or accurate as single shots. The weapon pulls up and to the right. Full automatic fire.
Lee tasted the words.
How does this repeater operate, if I may ask, sir? I have seen, for example, the Spencer repeating carbines the enemy cavalrymen employ, with a lever action to advance each successive bullet. But you work no lever save to chamber your first round. The rifle simply fired again and again.
When the charge in a round explodes, it makes a gas that rapidly expands and pushes the bullet out of the muzzle. Do you follow me?
Certainly, sir. If I may remind you, I was an engineer.
Lee felt irked at being asked so elementary a question.
That's right, so you were.
Rhoodie spoke as if reminding himself. He went on.
My weapon taps some of the gas and uses it to move the bolt back so the magazine spring can lift another round into the chamber. Then the cycle repeats itself until the magazine has no more ammunition left in it. Most ingenious.
Lee plucked at his beard, not wanting to go on. Southern inventors had come up with a great many clever ideas during the war, only to have them prove stillborn because of the Confederacy's feeble manufacturing capacity. Nevertheless, the question had to be asked.
With how many of these repeaters could you supply me?
Rhoodie smiled broadly.
How many would you like? I would like as many as you can furnish, Lee said. The use to which I might put them, however, would depend on the number available. If you can provide me with, say, 100, I might furnish them to horse artillery batteries, so they might protect themselves against attacks by the enemy infantry. If, on the other hand, you are fortunate enough to possess 500 or so, and the requisite ammunition, I would consider outfitting a cavalry regiment with them. It would be pleasant to have our horsemen able to match the firepower those people are able to bring to bear, rather than opposing them with pistols and shotguns.
Andres Rudy's smile grew wider still. Yet it was not the smile of someone sharing something pleasant with friends. Lee was reminded instead of the professional grimace of a stage magician about to produce two doves from inside his hat. Rhoodie said,
And suppose, General Lee, suppose I am able to get you 100,000 of these rifles, with their ammunition. How would the Confederacy use them?
100,000. Lee kept his voice low and steady, but only with a distinct effort. Rather than pulling two doves out of his hat, the big stranger had turned loose a whole flock.
Sir, that is not a piker's offer. Nor a likely one, if you will forgive my saying so,
Charles Marshall said.
That is nearly as many weapons as we have been able to realize from all of Europe in 3 years of war. I suppose you will deliver the first shipment by next northbound train?
Irony flavored every word. Rhoodie took no notice of it.
Close enough, he said coolly. My comrades and I have spent some time getting ready for this day. General Lee, you'll be sending General Hoke's brigade down to North Carolina over the next couple of nights. Am I right?
Yes, that is so, Lee said without much thought.
Then, all at once, he swung the full weight of his attention to Rhoodie.
"But how do you know of it, sir? I wrote those orders just today, and was in the process of informing President Davis of them when interrupted by you and your repeater. So how could you have learned of my plans for General Hoke's movements?"
"My comrades and I are well informed in any area we choose," Rhoodie answered. He was easy, even amused. Lee abstractly admired that. He knew his own presence overawed most men. The stranger went on.
"We do not aim to harm you or your army or the Confederacy in any way, General. Please believe me when I say that. No less than you, we aim to see the South free and independent."
"That all sounds very fine, but you did not answer the General's question," Marshall said.
He ran a hand through his slick, dark blonde hair as he took a step toward Rhoodie.
"How did you learn of General Hoke's movements?"
"I knew. That's enough." The stranger did not back down. "If you order the northbound train's engineer to stop at Rivington, General Lee, we'll put aboard the first shipment of rifles and ammunition. That would be, about 2,500 weapons, with several magazines worth of rounds for each. We can supply as many again the night after that, until your army is fully equipped with new pieces."
100,000 rifles would oversupply the Army of Northern Virginia," Lee said.
"The Confederacy has more armies than yours. Don't you think General Johnson will be able to use some when General Sherman brings the whole military division of the Mississippi down against him come spring?"
"General Grant commands the military division of the Mississippi," Walter Taylor said. "All the federal troops between the Alleghenies and the river."
"Oh, yes, that's right. So he does. For now."
"My mistake," Rhoodie said.
He turned back to Lee, this time with a hunter's intent expression on his face.
"And don't you think, General, that Nathan Bedford Forrest's troopers would enjoy being able to outshoot the Federals as well as outride and outfight them?"
"What I think, sir, is that you are building mighty castles in the air on the strength of a single rifle," Lee answered.
He did not care for the way Andres Rhoodie looked at him, did not care for the arrogant way the man spoke, did not care for anything about him, except for his rifle. If one Southern man could deliver the fire of 5 or 10 Unionists, the odds against which Confederate armies had to fight in every engagement might all at once be set at naught. Rhoodie still studied him. Lee felt his cheeks go hot, even on this icy winter's day, for he knew the stranger could see he was tempted. The book of Matthew came into his mind. "Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, and the glory of them, and saith unto him, All these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me." But Rhoodie did not ask for worship, and he was no devil, only a big, tough man, who was not too tough to wear a cap with flaps to keep his ears warm. For all that, Lee had not taken to him. He spoke like a reasonable man, and now said reasonably,
"General, I will stay here and guarantee with my person that what I say is true. Give the order for the train to stop and pick up the rifles and ammunition. If they do not come, as I say they will, why, you can do whatever you please with me. Where is your risk in that?"
Lee searched for one. Try as he would, he could not find it. To no one in particular, Charles Venable said,
"The fellow doesn't lack for brass, that's certain."
"No, he doesn't," Lee agreed.
The major's remark helped decide him.
"Very well, Mr. Rhoodie, I will give that order, and we shall see what arrives on that northbound train. If you make good on your claims, the first rifles will go to General Stuart's cavalry. After that, well, the divisions of General Anderson and Henry Heth are quartered closest to us here. Those men can have first call on the rifles among the infantry."
"If he makes good,"
Charles Marshall said heavily.
"What if he fails?"
"What would you recommend, Major?"
Lee asked, genuinely curious.
"A good horse whipping, to teach him to brag no more. How say you to that, Mr. Rhoodie? Lee inquired.
I'll take the chance, the stranger answered. Despite himself, Lee was impressed. Whether the fellow could do as he said remained to be seen, but he thought he could. Rhoodie went on.
With your permission, General, some of my comrades will ride north with the rifles. You'll need instructions to teach your men to use them properly.
They may come, Lee said. Afterwards, he thought that moment was the one when he first truly began to believe Andries Rhoodie. Began to believe a trainload of fancy repeaters and ammunition could arrive from North Carolina. Rhoodie was just too sure of himself to doubt. Walter Taylor asked,
Mr. Rhoodie, what do you call this rifle of yours? Is it a Rhoodie too? Most inventors name their products for themselves, do they not?
No, it's not a Rhoodie. The big stranger unslung the rifle, held it in both hands as gently as if it were a baby.
Give it its proper name, Major. It's an AK-47.
Lee returned to his tent to finish the delayed letter to President Davis and went back outside to see how his staff officers were dealing with Andries Rhoodie. Rhoodie, for his part, seemed perfectly ready to wait to be proved right. Either from that commodious haversack of his or from the pack behind his horse's saddle, he had taken out and erected a neat little one-man tent and was now building a fire in front of it. Majors Taylor, Venable, and Marshall stood around watching him. Each of them kept a hand close to his sidearm. It occurred to Lee, though, that with such a quick-firing repeater, Rhoodie might take advantage of a second's inattention to take out all three men before they could shoot back. The notion was unsettling. But the extraordinary repeater was inside the tent at the moment, and the big stranger showed not the slightest sign of hostility. He got his fire going on the first match and proceeded to warm his hands over it. Lee smiled a little. Rhoodie did not have the ear of a man about to attack everyone around him. He ducked into the tent, but emerged with nothing more lethal than a pot and a folding metal stand. He dipped up some water from a little brook that ran eventually into the Rapidan, then returned to his fire and put the pot over it to boil. Lee's servant came up.
Supper be ready soon, Mars Robert. Thank you, Perry. What do we have tonight? Possum soup, all nice and thick with peanuts, the black man answered. That sounds very fine.
Lee walked over to Rhoodie.
Would you care to share supper with me, sir? Perry has not much to work with here, but one would never know it by the meals he turns out.
Rudy's eyes flicked toward Perry.
Your slave? He's free, Lee answered.
Rhoodie shrugged. Lee could see he did not approve. The stranger started to say something, then evidently thought better of it, which was just as well. When he did speak, it was about supper.
Will you let me add to the meal? I know you're short on rations here. I wouldn't want to deprive you. Times are hard everywhere.
It's no trouble. I have plenty. Rhoodie peered into the pot.
Ah, good. It's boiling.
He set it on the ground.
Excuse me.
He went back into the tent. When he came out, he was holding a couple of packages whose sides and bottoms reflected the firelight metallically. He peeled the lid off each of them. The insides of the lids looked metallic, too. He set down the packages, poured hot water into each of them. Instantly, savory steam rose. Lee watched and sniffed with interest.
Is that desiccated stew you have there? The Federals use desiccated vegetables, but I did not know anyone was preparing whole meals that way.
Desiccated stew it is, General. The tall stranger's voice was oddly constrained, as if he'd expected Lee to be more surprised. He passed him one of the packages and a spoon.
Before you eat, stir it about a little.
Lee stirred, then tasted. His eyebrows rose.
This is excellent. Were they to taste it, the wits in the army wouldn't joke so about desecrated vegetables.
Yet another couple of spoonfuls.
Very good indeed. Now I find myself embarrassed at having nothing better than possum soup to offer in exchange.
Don't fret about it, General, Rhoodie said. He held out his metal packet as a bowl when Perry came by a couple of minutes later with the kettle. Perry ladled the container full. He smiled.
You have nothing to be embarrassed about. Your Black is a fine cook.
He does seem to work miracles, doesn't he? He has to these days, I fear.
Lee finished the last of his stew. Even desiccated, it had more and finer ingredients than he was used to. He could still feel their rich savor in his mouth. He said,
Mr. Rhoodie, you've spoken glibly of all the rifles you can furnish us. Can you also supply desiccated rations of this sort? Enough to hold hunger at bay in this army until spring?
Our firm is chiefly concerned with weapons. As far as rations go, I will have to inquire before I tell you how many we can bring in.
I wish you would, Lee said. A soldier who cannot march and fight is about as much a loss to his country as one without a rifle.
I'll do what I can, Rhoodie said. I don't know how much that will be. We're ready to move with the rifles now. For food, we would have to begin to make special arrangements, and they might take some time.
You know your own affairs best, I'm sure. I merely say that, if practicable, rations would be of material benefit to us.
Lee got to his feet. So did the big stranger. He started over to the brook with his pot. Lee said,
Surely you aren't still hungry, sir.
I was going to boil water for coffee. Would you like some?
Real coffee?
Lee asked. Rhoodie nodded. With a rueful smile, Lee said,
I almost think real coffee might be too potent for me, after so long drinking chicory and scorched grain masquerading under the name. Still, I will gladly hazard the experiment, provided you have enough for my staff as well. I would not see them deprived of what I enjoy.
They're welcome, Rhoodie said. They need their own mugs, though.
By all means,
Lee called his aides, gave them the good news. They exclaimed in delight and hurried back to their tents. Lee went off to fetch his own mug. By the time everyone converged, mug in hand, on Rudy's shelter, he had his pot back over the fire. With his free hand, he passed each Confederate officer a small flat packet. Rhoodie said,
Tear it, open, and pour it into the bottom of your cup.
Folger's Instant Coffee, Lee read on the packet. Below that, in much smaller print, was something he could not make out. He put on his glasses. The words came clear. Made in USA. He returned the glasses to his pocket, thinking he should have been able to guess that without reading it. As Rhoodie had directed, he poured the contents of the packet into his cup. The stuff did not look like ground coffee.
Is this another of your desiccations?
He asked.
You might say so, yes, General. Now, if you'll hold out your cup.
Rhoodie filled it to the brim with hot water. All at once, it smelled like coffee.
Stir it about to dissolve it all,
Rhoodie said, as he filled the aide's mugs in turn. Lee raised the cup to his lips. It was not the best coffee he had ever had, but coffee it unmistakably was. He took a long, slow sip, closed his eyes with pleasure.
That is most welcome, he said.
One after another, the staff officers echoed him.
I'm glad you enjoy it, Rhoodie said.
Charles Venable had been examining his packet, too.
Instant coffee, he said musingly. An apt description, though not one I've heard before. Is this little envelope made of tinfoil, Mr. Rhoodie?
I think so,
the big stranger answered after a slight hesitation, which Lee believed he recognized. It sounded like the pause of a man who was not telling everything he knew. Andries Rhoodie seemed to know a fair number of things he wasn't telling. The things he had already spoken of and shown were quite remarkable enough. Lee wondered what secrets he still kept. Walter Taylor pointed to Rudy's coffee mug.
"What is that emblem your cup bears, sir, if I may ask? At first, seeing the red background and the white, I took it for a Confederate symbol, but now I see it is not."
Rudy held the mug close to the fire to give Taylor a better view of it. Lee looked, too. Inside a white circle, on the red background, was a spiky black emblem that reminded him of a caltrop. Under the emblem stood three letters, AWB. Rudy said,
"It is the sign of my organization."
He was good at appearing to answer while actually saying little. Lee asked,
"What do the initials signify?"
"Our motto," Rudy replied with a smile. "America will break."
Taylor raised his mug in salute.
"I'll drink to that, by God."
The other aides followed suit. So did Lee. He had stayed in the Federal Army as long as he could. But when Virginia left the Union, he went with his state. It counted for more with him than did the idea of the United States.
"Another cup, gentlemen?" Rudy asked. "I have more coffee."
The staff officers said yes in a chorus. Coffee won them over where even Rudy's repeater had left suspicion in its wake. Lee declined.
"After so long without, a second cup would surely leave me wakeful. At my age, I find I must be careful of my sleep, for I need it more, but have more trouble winning it."
Nodding to Rudy, he turned to go. His aides saluted. He returned the courtesy and walked slowly back to his tent. He took off his boots and jacket, lay down on the cot, and pulled several blankets over himself. Even with them, the night would be cold. Most of his men had but a single cover. Many had none. The surgeons would see frostbite and catarrh come morning sick call. That happened every day. The coffee did not keep him from falling asleep. It woke him a couple of hours later, though. He stood up to use the chamber pot. The ground chilled his toes through his socks. Before he went back to bed, he glanced out through the tent flap. Andres Rhoodie had kept his fire large and bright. He was sitting in front of it in a folding chair of gaudy canvas webbing and wood. He did not notice Lee, being intent on the book in his lap.
"What are you reading, sir, at this late hour?" Lee called softly.
Rhoodie looked up and peered into the night. With his eyes full of firelight, he needed a few seconds to catch sight of Lee. When he did, he stuck a thumb in the book to keep his place, then shut it and held it up. A golden cross gleamed on the black cover.
"Ah,"
Lee said, all at once feeling easier about Rudy than he had since the moment he'd met him.
"You could find no better companion by day or night. May I ask which verses you have chosen?"
"The story of Gideon," the big stranger answered. "I read it often. It seems to fit."
"It does indeed," Lee said. "It does indeed. Good night, sir. I hope you sleep well when you do seek your bedroll."
"Thank you, General. A good night to you, too."
Lee went back to bed. As he told Rudy, he often had trouble sleeping. Not tonight, though. He dropped off as smoothly and easily as a child. Just before he stopped thinking altogether, he wondered why. Maybe it was hope. Something that had been in short supply since Gettysburg. He slept. The next couple of days went by in something close to a state of anticlimax. General Samuel Jones of the Department of Western Virginia sent a letter promising cattle and beef for the Army of Northern Virginia. Lee wrote effusive thanks, but the promised animals were slower arriving than Jones's letter had been. As he'd feared, it had reduced the Army's rations. Just after he'd finished drafting the general order for the melancholy necessity, Charles Venable poked his head into the tent.
"Telegram for you, sir."
He paused for dramatic effect.
It's from Rivington.
Read it to me at once, Major, Lee said.
Yes, sir.
Venable unfolded the flimsy sheet of paper. Stopped at Rivington northbound per your orders of January 20. Many crates of two different shapes taken on board. Townsfolk helpful and well organized. After departing, opened two crates at random, one of each type. Contents, metal cartridges and carbines of curious manufacture. A dozen men also boarded. Asbury Finch, First Lieutenant, CSA.
Well, well, Lee said, and then again. Well, well. Our mysterious Mr. Rhoodie does indeed have the rifles he promised, or some of them, at any rate. Despite his certainty, I wondered. I truly did.
I did more than wonder, sir, Venable answered. I doubted, and doubted strongly. But as you say, he seems to have kept the first part of his promise.
So he does. When General Stuart sees what these carbines can do, he will want no others. The repeaters, which ever more the Federal cavalry employ, have hurt his troopers badly. Now he will be able to reply on equal or better than equal terms. And if Mr. Rhoodie was not spinning a tail out of moonshine, there will be rifles for our infantry as well. I wonder how much the Bureau of Ordnance is paying for these. What did he call them?
AK-47s, Lee supplied. Whatever the price, it may well mark the difference between our liberty and suppression. It would be difficult to set that price too high.
Yes, sir.
Venable hesitated, then went on.
May I ask, sir, what do you think of Mr. Rhoodie?
Well, I certainly think a good deal better of him now that I know for a fact he is not a solitary charlatan with a solitary, if marvelous, carbine, Lee said at once. Then he too paused.
But that wasn't the whole of what you asked, was it, Major?
No, sir. Normally a fluent speaker, Venable seemed to be struggling to put what he thought into words.
I do believe he is the most peculiar man I've ever met. His carbine, his gear, even the food he eats and the coffee he drinks. I've not seen nor heard of their like anywhere.
Nor have I. And with their uniform excellence and convenience, I should hope I would have, the better to wage this war, Lee said. There is also more to it than that. The man knows more than he lets on. How could he have learned of my orders sending General Hoke south? That still perplexes me, and worries me no small amount as well. Had he been exposed as a fraud, I would have had some hard questions to ask him about it, and ask them in as hard way as need. As is, Lee shrugged, he is manifestly a good Southern man. How long do you suppose we could have lasted, Major, had he chosen to go north and sell his rifles to the enemy?
Venable made a sour face, as if disliking the taste of that idea.
Not long, sir. I quite agree. They outweigh us enough as is, but he chose our cause instead. So for the time being, the hard questions can wait. And he is a pious man. No one who is not would read his testament late at night where nobody could be expected to see him.
Every word you say is true, sir, Venable said. And yet, I don't know. Everything Rhoodie has seems too good to be true somehow.
The Union has had the advantage in material goods all through the war, Major. Are you saying we are not entitled to our share, or that, if fortune should for once choose to favor us, we ought not to take advantage of it?
Put that way, no. Of course not, General Lee.
Good, Lee said, for I intend to wring every drop of advantage from it that I may.
A plume of wood smoke announced a train heading up the Orange and Alexandria Railroad to the little town of Orange Courthouse. Lee pointed to it with the eagerness of a boy who spies his Christmas present being fetched in.
If I have calculated rightly, gentlemen, that will be the train from Rivington. Shall we ride to meet it and see this first consignment of Mr. Rhoodie's rifles?
His aides hurried off to get their horses. Andries Rhoodie went with them. Perry brought up Traveler. Lee swung on to the gray. The staff officers and Rhoodie soon joined them. They rode down from the hills of Orange Courthouse together. Lee and his aides were all fine horsemen. He soon saw Rhoodie was not, though he managed well enough. Old civilian men, walking or riding along the streets of Orange Courthouse, lifted their hats in tribute to Lee as he passed. He gravely returned their greetings. Few young male civilians were to be seen, in the town or anywhere else in the Confederacy. There were a fair number of soldiers, seeing what the shops had to offer. Not much, probably. They saluted Lee and his staff officers. Some pointed at Andres Rhoodie, his size, his strange clothes, and the fact that he, a stranger, rode with Lee, drew their notice to him. The train station was not far from the courthouse that gave the hamlet half its name. For that matter, nothing in Orange Courthouse was far from anything else. The train had already arrived by the time Lee and his companions got to the station. Under the watchful eye of the crew, slaves loaded cut logs into the tender for the next trip south. Other blacks were starting to unload the freight cars. Some of the men who supervised them wore the Confederate uniform. Others were dressed like Andres Rhoodie, in caps and mottled jackets and trousers. Even their ankle boots were the same as his. Lee rubbed his chin thoughtfully. What one man wore was his own business. When a dozen men, a baker's dozen, counting Rhoodie himself, wore similar outfits, that suggested the clothes were a uniform of sorts. Indeed, Rudy's colleagues looked more uniform than the Southern soldiers with them, whose pants, coats, and hats were of several different colors and cut in a variety of ways. Behind Lee, Walter Taylor turned to Rhoodie and remarked, "Your friends are all good-sized men, sir." He was right. The smallest of the men in spotted clothes had to be 5'10". Most of them were six-footers. Two or three were as big as Rhoodie. They all looked well-fed, too, in spite of the war and the hard winter. The Confederate soldiers came to attention when Lee and his aides rode up. The men from Rivington did not. A few of them greeted Rhoodie with a nod or a wave. Most just kept calling orders to the slaves, who were taking crates off the train. "Your fellows here have the same interesting accent as you yourself," Charles Venable observed. "We are countrymen," Rhoodie said blandly. Lee smiled at the major's polite probe and at Rudy's equally polite but uninformative reply. Rhoodie had given a lot of polite but uninformative replies the last few days. Lee told himself that a trainload, maybe a great many trainloads, of repeaters and cartridges, gave him the right to hold his tongue. Lee dismounted. His aides and Rhoodie followed him to the ground. Venable hitched Traveler to the rail. A soldier with two bars on either side of his collar walked up to them. His face, Lee thought, was too thin for the whiskers he'd chosen, which were like those of Federal General Burnside. He saluted.
"Asbury Finch, sir, 21st Georgia." "Yes, Lieutenant, I received your telegram."
"Yes, sir."
Finch sent a glance to Andres Rhoodie, who'd gone over to greet his comrades.
"So you've already met one of these all-over spots fellows, have you, sir? They've purely done wonders for Rivington, that they have." "I commanded in North Carolina a couple of years ago, Lieutenant, but I must confess I do not remember the town," Lee said. "A couple of years ago, General Lee, sir, wasn't nothing worth remembering. Just a town barely big enough for the train to bother stopping at it. But it's growing to beat the band now, thanks to these folks. A big bunch of them done settled there, bought a raft of niggers, and run up new houses and warehouses, and I don't know what all. And all in the last 3-4 months, too. I heard that from one of the folks who's lived there all his life while we were taking on these crates. They pay gold for everything, too, he says."
"No wonder they're welcome, then," Lee said. Confederate paper money had weakened to the point where a pair of shoes cost a private soldier 3 or 4 months' wages. That was one reason so many men in the Army of Northern Virginia went barefoot, even in winter. Another was that there was not enough shoes to be had at any price.
"Pity they couldn't have come a year ago," Walter Taylor said. "Think what we might have done with those rifles at Chancellorsville or up in Pennsylvania."
"I have had that thought myself a fair number of times the last few days, Major," Lee said. "What's past is past, though, and cannot be changed."
"The guns, they're as fine as all that, sir?" Finch asked.
"They are indeed, Lieutenant," Taylor said.
"With them, I feel we truly may hold in our hands the goose that lays the golden eggs."
"Or it holds us," Charles Marshall said, his voice sour. Lee looked at him sharply. Marshall had not taken to Andries Rhoodie, not at all. But after a moment's thought, Lee decided he had a point. Trainloads of repeating carbines might save the Confederacy. But if Rhoodie and his friends were the only source for them, they held a hand to the throat of the South. They were not squeezing now, far from it. If, however, they chose to.
"Major Marshall," Lee said.
"Sir?"
"Please draft a letter to Colonel Gorkus in Richmond. I would like his opinion on the practicability of our manufacturing copies of these weapons, as we do now with the Springfield and Mississippi rifles. When the first shipment of rifles reaches our headquarters, you might also send one and a stock of cartridges to Colonel G.W. Raines in Georgia, who is, I think, the man most expert in the Bureau of Ordnance on matters pertaining to powder. Perhaps he can enlighten us on how these rounds produce so little smoke."
"I will attend to it, sir," Marshall said.
His spectacles' wire frames could not hide a raised eyebrow.
"Your trust in Mr. Rhoodie is not perfect, then?"
"The only perfect trust is in God," Lee answered.
Marshall smiled and nodded. A relative of the great Chief Justice, he had been a lawyer till the war began, which gave him another reason besides religion to place perfect trust in no human institution. Just then, Rhoodie came back to Lee, his staff officers, and Lieutenant Finch. Several of his friends were right behind him. He said,
"General, let me introduce some of my comrades. Here are Conrad DeBise, Wilhelm Gebhard, Benny Lang, and Ernie Graff."
"Gentlemen," Lee said, extending his hand. They came up one by one to shake it.
"In order to meet the great General Lee," Ernie Graff said.
He was about Lee's height and wore a neat, sandy chin beard, which only partially hid a scar that ran up to the angle of his jaw. As Major Venable had noted, he and the rest of the men in mottled clothes spoke with the same not-quite-British accent as Rhoodie, and the same harsh undertone, if anything, that was stronger in his voice than in Rhoodie's.
"You needn't say my name as if you found it in some history book, sir,"
Lee protested mildly. All of Rhoodie's comrades smiled or laughed at that, rather more than the small joke deserved. Even so, Lee was pleased to put them at their ease.
"General Stuart is the man I want to meet," said the one who had been introduced as Conrad DeBise.
Most of the strangers had a businesslike look to them, but DeBise's tawny eyes held a gleam that reminded Lee of a cougar. This man fought for the joy of it. Then Lee remembered how Rhoodie rode. DeBise would have to do better than that to satisfy Jeb Stuart.
"You were a horseman, sir?" Lee asked.
DeBise nodded in a way that left no doubt. Lee said,
"Then I am certain General Stuart would be pleased to make your acquaintance as well. Colonel Mosby also, perhaps, with his partisan command."
By the way DeBise grinned, Lee knew he had judged his man aright.
"General Stuart is by Fredericksburg?"
Wilhelm Gebhard asked. He turned the soft G of General hard, as a German might have. Behind Lee, one of his aides whispered Dutchman to another. Lee guessed it was Marshall. He seemed most dubious of Rhoodie, and the bulk of Germans in America, including a good many who lived in the Confederacy, were Unionists. But these men were far too open and far too strange to be spies, and in any case,
General Meade knew where the Army of Northern Virginia's cavalry was passing the winter.
"Yes, around Fredericksburg," Lee answered.
He would sooner have had Stuart's troopers closer to hand. But getting horses through the winter was harder and required more land than men did. Gebhard turned to Rhoodie, asked him something in a language that sounded close to English, but was not. Rhoodie replied in the same tongue. "Dutchmen they are," Lee thought. In English, Rhoodie said, "He wants to know whether he and Debye's should arrange to go to Fredericksburg to show off our guns, or whether you will call General Stuart here." Lee thought about that. At last, he said,
"With the cavalry spread out on the countryside as it is, the more efficient course would appear to be convening General Stuart and his divisional and brigade commanders here at Orange Courthouse, so they can judge your repeaters for themselves."
"Fine," Rhoodie said. "When we shoot, though, better we go back up to your headquarters to keep word of what these guns can do from reaching the enemy."
"A sensible plan," Lee agreed.
Talking to himself as much as to Lee, Rhoodie went on. "Since this will be the center from which we give out guns to your army, we ought to rent quarters here, and a warehouse space, too. We have a lot of work to do before spring, getting your men ready. The officers of the Army of Northern Virginia should prove of some assistance to you," Lee said dryly. Irony bounced from Andres Rhoodie, like solid shot off an ironclad's armored hull. He looked Lee full in the face and said, "Some will help us, General. I don't doubt it. But if I were on the other side of the Rapidan and dealing with the Federals, say with General Burnside or General Siegel, they might not even have given me a hearing. They have their Springfields, after all. And once a routineer settles in with something, it's hard to boot him loose from it."
"You'll be treating with better men in this army than the two you named," Lee said. "I should certainly hope so, at any rate." "You vouch for every brigadier, every colonel?" Rhoodie persisted.
"My comrades and I haven't enough manpower to do more than show the basics of how to shoot and clean the AK-47, regiment by regiment. Getting your soldiers to use it afterwards will be up to those commanders. Some of them will mistrust anything new and different."
"I see what you are saying, sir," Lee admitted.
There was some truth to it, too. The Confederate states themselves had banded together in the hope of preserving their old way of life against the growing numbers and growing factories of the North. But here,
"You get my men these repeaters, Mr. Rhoodie, and I shall undertake to see they are used."
"That's what I wanted to hear, General Lee."
"You have heard it."
Singing as they worked, slaves carried long crates with rifles in them and square crates of ammunition out of the freight cars and stacked them beside the railroad tracks. The stacks grew higher and higher and higher.
2. "What else, Elsie?" First Sergeant Nate Cardell asked patiently. Private Elsie Hopkins furrowed his brow, as well as a man in his early 20s could.
"Tell him I feel good," he said at last. "Tell him the arm where I got shot at Gettysburg don't hurt no more, and the diarrhea ain't troubling me neither."
Cardell's pen scratched across the page. Actually, it wasn't a proper page, but the back of a piece of old wallpaper. He wrote around a chunk of paste that still clung to it. He was sure he wrote more letters than anyone else in Company D, maybe more than anyone else in the whole 47th North Carolina. That went with being a schoolteacher in a unit full of farmers, many of whom, like Elsie Hopkins, could neither read nor write for themselves.
"What else, Elsie?"
he asked again. Hopkins thought some more.
"Tell him we had us a rip-roaring snowball fight the other day, and one fella, he got 2 teeth knocked out of his head when he got hit with a snowball with a rock in the middle of it. We all laughed and laughed."
"Except the man who got hit," Cardell said dryly.
"No, him too."
Cardell thought that likely to amuse Hopkins' family, so he started to write it down. Just then, though, a bugle call came through the open shutters of his cabin's single window. He put down his pen.
"Have to finish this another time, Elsie.
That's assembly for officers, sergeants, and corporals. Everybody but us privates, Hopkins said,
happy at the prospect of his superiors working when he didn't have to.
Can I leave this paper here, First Sergeant? If we get it done maybe some time later on?
I suppose so, Cardell said resignedly. His battered felt slouch hat lay beside him on the bed. He put it on, got to his feet. I've got to go now, though. He and Hopkins ducked out through the cabin's low door. With nothing better to do, the private ambled away. Cardell hurried up the lane that ran through the cabins and lean-tos and tents of the regiment's winter quarters. His cabin, which he shared with the other four sergeants of Company D, lay farthest from the open space at the center of the encampment. Closest to that open space was Captain Lewis's tent. Being captain, he had it all to himself. The company banner stood beside it. The words, Castilia Invincibles, picked out in red silk on a blue ground, pierced by more than one bullet hole. Men with chevrons or collar badges converged on the parade ground. They did not begin to fill it up. They were perhaps one part in seven of the 600-odd soldiers who regularly drilled there. Along with all the officers and non-commissioned officers was one private, Ben Whitley of Company A. As usual, the teamster perched on his wagon. With him sat another man, a stranger, whose cap, coat, and trousers looked to be made of nothing but patches, some the color of dirt, some of grass, some of mud. Slung on the stranger's back was a carbine of unfamiliar make. Excitement ran through Cardell. The cavalry had got itself new rifles the past couple of weeks. So had Major General Anderson's infantry division, whose winter quarters were even closer to Orange Courthouse than those of Henry Hett's division, of which the 47th North Carolina was a part. If half, if a tithe, of the stories about those rifles were true. Colonel George Faribault limped around from the far side of the wagon. He moved slowly and with the aid of a stick. He'd been wounded in the foot and in the shoulder at Gettysburg and was just back to the regiment. By his pallor, even standing was not easy for him. He said,
Gentlemen, it is as you may have guessed. Our brigade and our division are next to receive the new repeater, the AK-47, they call it. Here, he pointed to the stranger in the suit of many muddy colors, is Mr. Benny Lang, who will show you how to operate the rifle, so you can go on and teach your men. Mr. Lang.
Lang jumped lightly down from the wagon. He was about 5'10", dark, and on the skinny side. His clothes bore no rank badges of any sort, but he carried himself like a soldier.
I usually get two questions at a time like this, he said. The first one is, why don't you teach everyone yourself? Sorry, but we haven't the manpower. Today, my friends and I are working with General Kirkland's brigade. That's you people. The 11th North Carolina, the 26th North Carolina, the 44th North Carolina, and the 52nd North Carolina. Tomorrow, we'll be with General Cook's brigade, and so on. You'll manage. You have to be more than stupid to screw up an AK-47. You have to be an idiot, and even then it's not easy.
Listening to him, Cardell found himself frowning. Camp rumor said these fellows in the funny clothes were not merely from North Carolina, but from his own home country, Nash. Lang didn't sound like a Carolina man, though, or like any kind of Southerner. He didn't sound like a Yankee, either. In the past 2 years, Cardell had heard plenty of Yankee accents. The first sergeant kept listening.
The other question I hear is, why bother trying anything new when we're happy with our regular rifles? I'd sooner show you why than tell you. Who's your best chap with Springfield or Enfield or whatever you use?
All eyes swung to the regimental ordnance sergeant. He was a polite, soft-spoken man. He looked around to see if anyone else would volunteer. When no one did, he took a step forward out of line.
Reckon I am, sir, George Hines.
Very good, Lang said.
Would you be so kind as to fetch your weapon and ammunition for it? And while he's doing that, Private Whitley, why don't you move the wagon so we don't frighten the horses?
Sure will.
Whitley drove the team perhaps 50 feet, then jumped down and walked back over to watch what was going on. Ordnance Sergeant Hines returned a minute or so later, rifle musket on his shoulder. He carried the piece like a part of him, as befit any man who wore a star in the angle of his sergeant's stripes. Benny Lang pointed to a tall bank of earth that faced away from the soldiers' huts.
Is that what you use for target practice?
Yes, sir, it is, Hines answered.
Lang trotted over, pinned a circular paper target to the bank. He trotted back to the group, then said,
Ordnance Sergeant Hines, why don't you put a couple of bullets in that circle for us, fast as you can load and fire?
I'll do that, Hines said,
while the men who stood between him and the target moved hastily out of the way. Watching the ordnance sergeant handle his rifle, Nate Caudill thought, was like being back on the target range at Camp Mangum outside of Raleigh, hearing the command,
Load in 9 times. Load.
Hines did everything perfectly, smoothly, just as the manual said he should. To load, he held the rifle upright between his feet, with the muzzle in his left hand, and with his right already going to the cartridge box he wore at his belt. Caudill imagined the invisible drill master barking,
Handle cartridge!
Hines brought the paper cartridge from the box to his mouth, bit off the end, poured the powder down the muzzle of his piece, and put the mini-ball in the muzzle. The bluntly pointed bullet was about the size of the last joint of a man's finger, with 3 grooves around its hollow base, which expanded to fill the grooves on the inside of the rifle barrel. At the remembered command of,
Draw rammer!
The long piece of iron emerged from its place under the rifle barrel. Next in the series was,
Ram!
Which the ordnance sergeant did, with a couple of sharp strokes before returning the ramrod to its tube. At
Prime!
He half-cocked the hammer with his right thumb, then took out a copper percussion cap and put it on the nipple. The next 4 steps went in quick sequence.
Shoulder!
Brought the weapon up.
At Ready!
It went down again for a moment, while Hines took the proper stance. Then up it came once more, with his thumb fully cocking the hammer.
Aim!
At him peering down the sights, his forefinger set on the trigger.
Fire!
And the rifle roared and bucked against his shoulder. He set the butt end of the piece on the ground, repeated the process without a single changed motion. He fired again. Another cloud of fireworks-smelling smoke spurted from his rifle. The 2 shots were less than 30 minutes apart. He scrubbed at the black powder stain on his chin with his sleeve, then turned with quiet pride to face Lang.
Anything else, sir?
No, Ordnance Sergeant. You're as good with a rifle musket as any man I've seen.
However,
Lang brought up his own rifle, blazed away at the white paper target. The sharp staccato bark, repeated again and again and again, was like nothing Caudill had ever heard. Silence fell again in less time than Hines had needed to fire twice.
Lang said, That was 30 rounds. If I had this weapon and the ordnance sergeant that one, whose chances would you gentlemen like better?
God damn,
somebody behind Caudill said softly, stretching the word out into 3 syllables. It seemed as good an answer as any, and better than most. Benny Lang drove the point home anyhow.
If you had this weapon, and the Federals that one, whose chances would you gentlemen like?
For a long moment, no one replied. No one needed to. Privates came dashing out of the parade ground, drawn as if by magnets to learn what sort of rifle had fired like that. Then somebody cut loose with a rebel yell. In an instant, the shrill, hair-raising cry rose from every throat. Caudill yelled with the rest. Like most of them, he had come back from Pickett's charge. Far too many of their one-time comrades hadn't. Not in the face of the barrage the Federals poured down on them. He was all in favor of having the firepower on his side for a change. Colonel Farabault waved the private soldiers off the drill field.
Your turn will come,
he promised. The men withdrew, but reluctantly. While that was going on,
Benny Lang walked over to the wagon, lowered the tailgate, and began taking out repeaters like the one he had reslung. Nate Caudill's palms itched to get hold of one. Lang said,
"I have 24 rifles here. Why don't you men form by companies, 2 groups to a company? And Private Whitley and I will pass them out so I can show you what you need to know."
A few minutes of milling about followed, as men joined with others from their units. Caudill and his messmates, Sergeants Powell, High, Daniel, and Yuri, naturally gravitated together. That left the Invincibles' 2 corporals who were present for duty grouped with Captain Lewis and his pair of lieutenants.
"It's all right," Lewis said. "We're all new recruits at this business."
"Here you go, First Sergeant."
Ben Whitley handed Caudill a repeater. He held it in both hands, marveling at how light it was, compared to the Springfield that hung from pegs on the wall back in his cabin. He slung it as Lang had done. It seemed to weigh next to nothing on his shoulder. Toting this kind of rifle, a man might march forever before he got sore.
"Let me have a turn with it, Nate,"
Edwin Powell said. With a twinge of regret, Caudill passed him the carbine. He brought it up to firing position, looked down the barrel.
"Fancy kind of sight," he remarked.
His grin turned rueful.
"Maybe I can nail me a Yankee or two without getting hit my own self. Going up to the firm line without your shoot me sign would probably be a good idea too, Edwin,"
Dempsey Urey said. The sergeants all laughed. So far as anybody knew, Powell was the only man in the regiment who'd been wounded at 3 different fights. Ben Whitley came by again a few minutes later. This time, he gave Caudill a curved, black-painted metal object. Caudill had no idea what it was, until he turned it and saw that it held brass cartridges.
"Talk about your fancy now, Edwin," he said, handing it on to Powell. "This looks to beat mini-balls all hollow."
"Sure does, if there's enough of these here bullets so as we don't run out halfway through a battle," Powell answered.
Anybody who'd been shot 3 times developed a certain concern about such things.
"Does every group have an AK-47 and a banana clip?" Lang asked.
He waited to see if anyone would say no. When no one did, he continued.
"Turn your weapon upside down.
In front of your trigger guard, you'll see a catch. It holds the clip in place."
He pointed to it on his own carbine.
"Everyone finger that catch. Pass your weapon back and forth. Everyone needs to put hands on it, not just watch me."
When the AK-47 came back to him, Caudill obediently fingered the catch. Lang had the air of a man who'd taught this lesson many times and knew it backwards and forwards. As a teacher himself, Caudill recognized the signs. The man in the patchwork-looking clothes went on.
"Now, everyone take turns clicking the clip into place and freeing it. The curved end goes toward the muzzle. Go ahead, try it a few times."
Caudill inserted the clip, released the catch, took it away. Lang said,
"This is one place where you want to be careful. Warn your other ranks about it, too. If the lips of the magazine are bent, or if you get dirt in there, it won't feed rounds properly. In combat, that could prove embarrassing."
He let out a dry chuckle. The laughs that rose in answer were grim. A rifle that wouldn't shoot hundreds of rounds a minute was less use than one that would shoot 2 or 3. In the group next to Caudill, his captain stuck up his hand.
"Mr. Lang?"
"Yes, Captain, I'm George Lewis, sir. What do we do if the lips of this banana clip, you called it, somehow do get bent? I've been shot once, sir."
He was only recently back to the regiment himself.
"And I don't care a damn to be, embarrassed again."
"Don't blame you a bit, Captain.
The obvious answer is, switch to a fresh clip. If you haven't but 1 good one left, you can load cartridges into it 1 at a time, in 2 staggered rows, like this. As I said when I fired, the clip holds 30 rounds.
He pulled a clip and some loose cartridges from his haversack and demonstrated.
"We'll come back to that later. You'll all have a chance to do it. Now, though, let whoever's holding the gun put that magazine in place."
Caudill was holding the AK-47. He carefully worked the banana clip into position,
listened for the click that showed it was where it belonged.
Good, Lang said. Now you're ready to chamber your first round. Here, pull this handle all the way back.
Again, he demonstrated. Caudell followed suit. The action worked with a resistant smoothness that was unlike anything he had ever felt before.
Very good, once more, Lang said. All of you with rifles come forward and form a firing line. Take aim at your target and fire.
Caudell pulled the trigger. Nothing happened. No one else's carbine went off either. The instructor chuckled.
No, they're not defective. Look at the short black lever under the handle you just pulled. See how it's parallel to the muzzle? That little lever is called the change lever. When it's in the top position, it's on safety, and the weapon can't fire. That's how you'll carry it on march, to avoid accidents. Now move it down two positions. Make sure it's two, mind. Then aim and fire again.
Caudell peered down the sights. They seemed close together. He was used to a longer weapon. He squeezed the trigger. The rifle barked and spat out a cartridge case. Compared to what he was used to, the kick was light.
Lordy, someone halfway down the line exclaimed. I could fire this piece right off my nose.
The kick wasn't that light, but it wasn't far away either.
Fire another round, Lang said. You don't have to do anything but pull the trigger again.
Caudell pulled. The repeater fired. Intellectually, he had expected it would. Intellectually, expecting something, though, was different from having it happen. The chorus of whistles and low-voiced exclamations of wonder that went up from the firing line showed he was not alone.
30 rounds to this thing? Somebody said. Hell, just load it on Sunday and shoot it all week long.
Lang said. Each time you fire, the spring in the magazine pushes up another round, so you have one in the chamber again.
Take off the magazine, why don't you? Then fire that last round to empty the weapon and pass it to someone in your group so he can have his three practice rounds.
Caudell moved the lever up, thumbed the catch that held the magazine where it belonged. When it separated from the carbine, he did not know what to do with it for a moment. Finally, he thrust it inside the front of his trousers. He aimed at the weapon, felt the light jolt of its kick when he fired.
My turn now,
Allison High said, tapping him on the shoulder. High was a half dozen years younger than Caudell, 2 inches taller, and several inches wider through the chest. Not only that, it was his turn. Even so, Caudell said,
I don't want to give it to you, Allison. I want to keep it to myself. It ain't your wife, Nate. It's only a gun,
High said reasonably.
Besides, from what this Lang fella's been saying, we'll each get one all our own for long.
A little embarrassed, Caudell surrendered the rifle and the banana clip. High clicked the magazine back into place. The sound reminded Caudell of a faithless lover's laugh as she slipped into the arms of someone new. He laughed, too, at himself. Benny Lang took the new firing line through the drill of working the change lever, chambering around and firing the rifle. The instructor had the knack of repeating his lessons without sounding bored. Caudell listened just as hard without the carbine in his hand as he had when he held it. Soon enough, he'd be teaching privates. He wanted to make sure he could stay ahead of them. Lang kept at it until everyone had had a turn shooting an AK-47. Then he said,
"This weapon can do one other thing I haven't shown you yet. When you move the change lever all the way down, instead of to the middle position, this is what happens."
He stuck a fresh clip in the repeater, turned toward the target circle, and blasted away. He went through the whole magazine, almost before Caudell could draw in a startled breath.
"Good God Almighty,"
Rufus Daniels said, peering in awe at the brass cartridge cases scattered around Lang's feet.
Why didn't he show us that in the first place?
He was not the only one to raise the question. Quite a few shouted it. Caudell kept quiet. By now, he was willing to assume Lang knew what he was doing. The weapons instructor stayed perfectly possessed. He said,
I didn't show you that earlier,
because it wastes ammunition, and because the weapon isn't accurate past a few meters, yards, on full automatic. You can only carry so many rounds. If you shoot them all off in the first 5 minutes of a battle, what will you do once they're gone? Think hard on that, gentlemen, and drill it into your private soldiers. This weapon requires fire discipline. Requires it, I say again.
He paused to let the point sink in. Then he grinned. It made him look like a boy. When he was serious, his thin, sallow features showed all his years, which had to be as many as Caudell's own 34. He said,
"Now we've done the exciting things with the weapon. Time to get on to the boring details that will keep it working and you alive. Cleaning and such."
A groan rose from his audience. The sort of groan Caudell was used to hearing when he started talking about subtracting fractions. Benny Lang grinned again. He went on.
"I warned you it wasn't glamorous. We'll get on with it just the same. Watch me, please."
He held up his repeater so everyone could see it.
"Look here at the top of the weapon, all the way back toward you from the sight. There at the end of the metal part is a little knob. It's called the recoil spring guide. Do you see it?"
Edwin Powell had the rifle in Caudell's group. Caudell looked it over with his fellow sergeants. Sure enough, the knob was there. Lang waited until he saw everyone had found it.
"Now," he said, "every chap with a weapon, push in on that knob."
Powell pushed, a little hesitantly. Caudell didn't blame him for being cautious. After all the marvels the AK-47 had displayed, he would not have been surprised to find that pushing that knob made it sing a chorus of "The Bonnie Blue Flag." Nothing so melodramatic happened. Lang was also pushing the knob on his repeater. As he did so, he went on.
"Lift up the receiver cover and take it off the receiver."
More clumsily, his students imitated him. Caudell peered curiously into the works of the weapon thus revealed.
"Never saw a rifle with so many guts," Dempsey Urey observed. "I never saw a rifle with guts at all," Caudell said,
to which the other sergeants nodded. A rifle was a barrel and a lock and a stock, plus such oddments as sight and ramrod and bayonet. It had no room for guts, but this one did. Caudell wondered what the unschooled farmers who made up the bulk of the Castilia Invincibles would think of that.
"Don't panic," Lang said.
Caudell remembered that the instructor had seen other soldiers' reactions to the complicated interior of an AK-47. Lang continued to take the carbine apart, lecturing all the while.
"We've already taken off the receiver cover, right? Next thing to do is push the recoil spring guide in as far as it will go and then lift it up and take it out along with the spring itself. Then slide the bolt carrier, the bolt, and the piston back and lift them out."
He held up each piece as he named it so his inexperienced pupils could see what he was talking about.
"Now watch how I turn the bolt. The lugs here have to line up with the grooves on the carrier. Then the bolt slides back until it comes off the carrier. You only really have to worry about the spring, the bolt carrier, and the bolt. You need to clean them every day the weapon is fired."
Lang pulled a rod out from under the barrel of the AK-47. The carbine stock had a hinged compartment. He took from it a little bottle of gun oil, brushes, and cloth patches. With meticulous care, he ran a patch down the inside of the barrel, then wiped the black spring and silvery bolt and carrier clean. When he was done, he resumed his discussion.
"Reassembly procedure is the exact reverse of what we've just done. The bolt goes on the carrier."
He deftly matched action to words.
"And they both go into the receiver. Then the recoil spring and its guide fit in back of the bolt carrier. Push them forward till the rear of the guide clears the back of the receiver. Then push down to engage the guide. Then you put the receiver plate in place, push in on the spring guide, and push the plate down to lock it."
He grinned at the North Carolinians.
"Now you try it. Don't bother cleaning your weapon this first time. Just get it apart and back together."
"That don't look too hard,"
Edwin Powell said. Cordell wasn't so sure. He didn't trust the look on Benny Lang's face. The last time he'd seen a look like that, Billy Benningfield of Company F had been wearing it in a poker game. Billy had also had an extra ace stuck up his sleeve. The spring, gleaming with gun oil, went back where it belonged, with no particular argument. The bolt was something else again. Powell tried to fit it into place, as Lang had. It did not want to fit.
Shitfire, Powell said softly after several futile tries. Far as I'm concerned, a damn thing can stay dirty.
He was far from the only man having trouble. Lang went from group to group, explaining the trick. There obviously was a trick, for people looked happier once he'd worked with them. After a while, he came to Cardell's group, where Powell was still wrestling with the bolt.
It goes on the carrier like this, he said.
His hands underscored his words.
Do you see?
Yes, sir, I think so, Powell answered, as humbly as if speaking to one of the Camp Mangum drill sergeants who had turned the 47th North Carolina from a collection of raw companies into a regiment that marched and maneuvered like a single living creature. Lang carried the same air of omniscience, even if he didn't display it so loudly or profanely. He said,
"Show me."
Powell still fumbled, but at last he got the bolt into place. Lang slapped him on the back.
"Good. Do it again."
Powell did, a little faster this time.
Lang said, "When you get your own weapon tomorrow, you'll practice till you can do it with your eyes closed. First try, every try."
Powell grunted.
"Been using guns my whole life. Never reckoned I'd have to put puzzle pieces together to make one work."
Oddly, that complaint cheered Nate Cardell. When he was a boy, his father had carved puzzles for him to play with. Thinking of the AK-47's works as a toy rather than something strange, mysterious, and threatening, let him attack them without feeling intimidated. When his turn came, he got the bolt back into place after only a couple of false starts.
"Do it again that fast, Nate, and I'll believe you really can," Allison High said.
Cardell did it again, and then, just to show it was no fluke, one more time. High whistled, a long, low note of respect.
"Might could even be a reason you're wearing that first sergeant's diamond to go with them stripes of yours. First time we've seen one, if there is,"
Dempsey Urey said. A grin eased the sting from the words. Urey had trouble taking anything or anyone seriously.
"To hell with both of you," Cardell said.
He and his messmates all laughed.
"Wonder what Sid Bartholomew would say if he was here to get a look at this repeater,"
Edwin Powell remarked. Everyone nodded. Nominally a member of Company D, Bartholomew was a gunsmith by trade, and had spent the whole war on detail in Raleigh, doing what he did best.
"Reckon he'd say good God almighty like the rest of us," Rufus Daniels said.
And everyone nodded again. The AK-47 brought on remarks like that. By the time everyone was able to clean and reassemble the repeater, morning had given way to afternoon. As he'd promised, Lang showed how to load cartridges into the rifle's magazine. After the mysteries of the bolt, that was child's play. He also showed how to open the catch at the bottom of the clip and clean the spring inside.
"That's a once-a-month job, though, not once a day," he said. "But do remember to see to it every so often."
He paused, looked around at his audience.
"You've been very patient chaps, the lot of you. Thank you for your attention. I've said everything I need to say. Have you any questions of me?"
"Yeah, I got one,"
somebody said immediately. Heads turned toward him as he took a swaggering step out of his group.
"You got your fancy pants rifle there, Mr. Benny Lang. Kill anything that twitches 20 miles away. What I want to know is, how good a man are you without it?"
He gazed toward Lang with insolent challenge in his eyes.
"Bedingfield!"
Captain Langford of Company F and Colonel Farabolt barked the name in the same breath. Cardell said it too, softly.
"How'd Billy Bedingfield ever make corporal?"
Rufus Daniel whispered.
"He could teach mean to a snapping turtle."
"You don't want to get on his wrong side, though," Cardell whispered back. "If I were a private in his squad, I'd be more afraid of him than of any Yankee ever born."
"You got that right, Nate," Daniel said, chuckling.
"Back in ranks, Benningfield,"
Captain Langford snapped.
"I don't mind, Captain," Benny Lang said.
"Let him come ahead if he cares to. This might be instructive, too. Come on, Corporal, if you've got the stomach for it."
He set down his repeater and stood waiting.
"Is he out of his mind?" Edwin Powell said. "Billy'll tear him in half."
Looking at the two men, Cardell found it hard to disagree. Lang was taller, but on the skinny side. Built like a bull, Bedingfield had to outweigh him by 20 pounds. And, as Rufus Daniel had said, Bedingfield had a mean streak as wide as he was. He was a terror in battle, but a different sort of terror in camp. He grinned a school bully's nasty grin as he stepped forward to square off with Lang.
"That man's face is made for a slap," Cardell said to Allison High. "Reckon you're right, Nate, but I got $10. Confed says Lang ain't the one to slap it for him,"
I answered. $10 Confederate was most of a month's pay for a private. Cardell liked to gamble now and then, but he didn't believe in throwing away money.
"No thanks, Allison. I won't touch that one."
High laughed. Edwin Powell said,
"I'll match you, Allison. That there Lang, he looks to have a way of knowing what he's doing. He wouldn't have called Billy out if he didn't expect he could lick him."
One of Cardell's sandy eyebrows quirked up toward his hairline. He hadn't thought of it in those terms.
"Can I change my mind?"
he asked High.
"Sure thing, Nate. I got another 10 that ain't doing nothing. I..."
He shut up. Big knobby fists churning. Bedingfield rushed at Benny Lang. Lang brought up his own hands, but not to hit back. He grabbed Billy Bedingfield's right wrist, turned, ducked, threw. Bedingfield flew over his shoulder, landed hard on the frozen ground. He bounced to his feet. He wasn't grinning anymore.
"Bastard!"
he snarled, and waded back in. A moment later, he went flying again. This time, he landed on his face. His nose dripped blood onto his tunic as he got up. Lang wasn't breathing hard.
"You fight dirty,"
Bedingfield said, wiping his face with his sleeve. Now Lang smiled coldly.
"I fight to win, Corporal. If you can't stand it, go home to your mama."
With a bellow of rage, Bedingfield charged. Cardell watched closely, but still didn't see just what happened. All he knew was that, instead of flying, Bedingfield went down. Hard. He moaned and tried to rise. Benny Lang stood over him, kicked him in the ribs with judiciously calculated force. He stayed down. Still unruffled, Lang said,
"Has anyone else any questions?"
No one did. He smiled that cold smile again.
"Colonel Farrelbolt, Captain, I think you'll find I didn't damage this fellow permanently."
"I wouldn't have blamed you if you had, sir. He picked the fight,"
Captain Langford said. He plucked at his chin beard.
"Maybe some hours bucked and gagged will teach him to save his spirit for the Yankees."
"Maybe." Lang shrugged. It wasn't his problem.
"Good day to you, gentlemen. Private Whitley, do you mind giving me a lift back to Orange Courthouse?"
"No, sir. Not a bit, sir, Mr. Lang."
Whitley hadn't sounded nearly so respectful before Lang knocked the stuffing out of Billy Bedingfield.
"Good."
Lang ambled toward the wagon.
"I could walk it easily enough, I suppose. It's only a mile and a half. But why walk when you can ride?" "I don't know who that Lang fella is or where he comes from," Edwin Powell declared. "But he thinks like the infantry."
The other sergeants from Company D solemnly nodded. Cardell said,
"Talk has it he and his people are from Rivington, right in our home county."
"You cut out that R and speak for your own self, Nate,"
Allison High said. Unlike his messmates, he was from Wilson County, just south of Nash. Rufus Daniels said,
"I don't give a damn how talk has it, and that's a fact. Here's two more facts. Lang don't talk like he's from Nash County.
He exaggerated his drawl till everyone around him smiled.
And he don't fight like he's from Nash County, neither. I wish he'd learn me that fancy wrestling of his along with this here repeater. Old Billy Bedingfield, he never knew what hit him. Look, he's still lying there cold as a torch throat in a snowbank.
The wagon started out of camp, harness jingling, wheels squeaking, and horses' hooves ringing against the ground. It swung off the camp lane onto the road north. Billy Bedingfield still did not move. Cardell wondered if Lang had hurt him worse than he thought. So evidently did Colonel Farabault. He limped over to the fallen corporal, stirred him with his stick. Bedingfield wiggled and moaned. Nodding as if satisfied, Farabault stepped back.
Flip water in his face, somebody, till he revives. Then Captain Langford, along with whatever punishment details you give him, have the stripes off his sleeves. A raw brawler like that doesn't deserve to wear them.
Yes, sir, Langford said. That's fair, Cardell said, after a couple of seconds' thought. No one in his group disagreed with him. A corporal from Company F ran off the parade ground, returned a minute later with his canteen, whose contents he poured over Bedingfield's head. The fallen bully spluttered and swore, and slowly sat up. Colonel Farabault said,
Each of today's groups will hold its rifle and practice as much as possible until the full regiment's rifles arrive, which, I am told, will be tomorrow.
His phrasing drew ironic chuckles. The time of promised shipments had a way of stretching like India rubber. He went on.
Try not to actually shoot, except at our target here, for safety's sake. Especially not when the rifle is on. What did Lang call it?
Full automatic, sir,
someone supplied.
That's it.
Farabault's mouth set in a grim line that his little mustache only accented.
A fool with an Enfield can hurt one man with an accidental shot. A fool with one of these new guns can mow down half a company if he starts with a full banana clip. Bear it in mind, gentlemen. You are dismissed.
Dempsey Urey carried the AK-47 as the sergeants started back to their cabin. He slung it over his shoulder, then said,
I'd sooner tote this than my old rifle any day. Don't hardly weigh nothing, do it,
Rufus Daniel echoed.
Stubby little thing, though,
Allison High said critically.
Wouldn't want to get into a bayonet fight or have to swing it like it was a club.
Daniel spat.
I leave the bayonet off my own rifle now when I'm going into a fight, Allison. So do most of the boys, and you know it too. You don't hardly ever get close enough to a Yankee to use the blamed thing. With these here new guns, they ain't going to get that close to us neither.
As was his habit, High kept looking at the darker side of things.
If they don't break down from use, and if Benny Lang and however many friends he's got can keep us in cartridges, I ain't never seen the likes of these before. Not even from the Yankees.
That's so, Daniel allowed. Well, we'll use them hard these next couple of months till we break camp. That'll tell us what we need to know. And if they ain't to be trusted, well, George Hines can put mini-balls in the ammunition wagons, too. We still got our old rifles. Be just like the first days of the war again when the Springfields and Enfields was the new guns. And a lot of the boys just had smoothbore muskets, and we needed to carry bullets for both. I don't miss my old smoothbore, and that's a fact, though I did a heap of missing with it when I carried it.
You got that right, Dempsey Urey said. Daniel Boone couldn't hit the side of a barn with a goddamn smoothbore, and anybody who says different is a goddamn liar. Goddamn right, Rufus Daniels said.
Before the war, Cardell would have boxed the ears of any boy who dared swear in his hearing. Now, half the time, he didn't even notice the profanity that filled the air around him. These days, he swore, too, when he felt like it. Not so much to fit in as because sometimes nothing felt better than a ripe round oath. He said,
Can't be sure, of course, but I have a notion we'll get all the cartridges we need. That Benny Lang, he knows what he's doing. Look at the way he handled Billy. Like Edwin said, he knew he could take him, and he did. If he says we'll have repeaters here tomorrow, I'm inclined to believe him. I expect he and his people can manage cartridges, too.
Double or nothing on our bet that them guns don't come tomorrow, High said. You're on, Cardell replied at once.
I want my 10 now, Edwin Powell said.
High turned around as if to punch him, then looked back to the parade ground. He pointed.
See, Nate? There's one man who don't know if you're right about them cartridges.
Cardell turned, too. George Hines was on his hands and knees, picking up spent cartridge cases.
He's a good ordnance, Sergeant, Cardell said. He doesn't want to lose anything. He doesn't have to.
Remember after the first day at Gettysburg, when they told off a couple of regiments to glean the battlefield for rifles and ammunition both?
I remember that, Powell said.
His long face grew longer.
I wish they could have gleaned from men, too.
He'd taken his second wound at Gettysburg. The sergeants ducked back into their cabin one by one. Rufus Daniels started building up the fire, which had died to almost cold embers while the five men took their long turn on the parade ground. Cardell sat down in a chair that had begun life as a molasses barrel.
Pass me that repeater, Dempsey, he said. I need to work with it more to get the proper hang of it.
We all do, Yuri said, as he handed over the carbine. Cardell practiced attaching and removing the magazine several times, then pushed in on the recoil spring guide and field-stripped the rifle. To his relief, he got the pieces back in the right way without too much trouble. He did it again and again. He told his students that reciting over and over made each subsequent recitation easier and better. He was glad to find the same true here. His hands began to know what to do of themselves, without having to wait for the thinking part of his mind to tell him.
"Give me a go with it now, Nate," Powell said. "You're slick as butter, and I was all fumble-fingered out there on the field."
Not too far away, a man started banging on a pot with a spoon.
"Mess call," Allison High said. "Edwin, it's your turn to fetch the grub. You'll have to fiddle with that repeater later on. Who gets the water tonight?"
"I do,"
Rufus Daniels said. He picked up his canteen, a wooden one shaped like a little barrel.
"Give me yours, too, Nate."
Cardell reached into his bunk, tossed his canteen to Daniel. It was metal covered with cloth, taken from a federal soldier who would never need water again. The two sergeants went back out into the cold. Dempsey Yuri said,
"Don't hog the rifle just on account of Edwin's gone, Nate. If wagon loads of them really do show up tomorrow, we'd all best know what we're doing, or we'll look like God Almighty fools in front of the men. Wouldn't be the first time," he added.
Fear of embarrassment, Cardell thought, as Yuri ran his hand over the chambering handle, was a big part of the glue that held the army together. Send a man alone against a firing line with no one to watch him, and he might well run away. Why not, when going forward made getting shot all too likely? But send a regiment against that same line, and almost everyone would advance on it. How could a man who'd fled face his mates afterwards? Rufus Daniel came back a few minutes later. He set the canteens down not far from the fireplace.
"Reckon Edwin'll be a bit. You don't have to stand in line by the creek the way you do for rations," he said. "While we're waiting, how about I try that there repeater?"
Everyone was eager to work with the new rifle as much as he could.
"What do you have, Edwin?"
Dempsey Yuri demanded when Powell returned. Cardell's stomach growled like a starving bear. He'd known some lean times before the war, what man hadn't, save maybe a planter like Farabault. But he'd never known what real hunger was till he joined the army. Powell said,
"Got me some cornmeal and a bit of beef. Likely be tough as mule leather. But I won't complain till after I get me outside of it. We still have any of that bacon your sister sent you, Dempsey?"
"Little bit,"
Yuri answered.
"You thinking of making up some good old Confederate kosh?"
"I will, unless you got a better notion," Powell said. "Ain't none of us what you'd call fancy cooks. Why don't you get out that bacon and toss me our frying pan? Here, Nate. You cut the beef small."
He handed Cardell the meat, the hairy skin still on it. The pan had once been half a federal canteen. Its handle was a nailed-on stick. Powell tossed in the small chunk of bacon and held the pan over the fire. When he had cooked the grease out so it bubbled and spattered in the bottom of the pan,
Cardell added the cubed beef. After a minute or two, he poured in some water. Meanwhile, Allison High used more water to make the cornmeal into a tin of mush. He passed the mush to Cardell, who upended the tin over the frying pan. Powell stirred the mixture together, then kept the pan on the fire until the mush soaked up all the water, and a brown crust began to form along the sides. He took the pan off the fire, set it down. With his knife, he sliced the kush into five or more less equal pieces.
There you go, boys. Dig in.
I hate this goddamn slush, Rufus Daniels said. When I get home from this damn war, I ain't gonna eat nothing but fried chicken and sweet potato pie and ham and biscuits and gravy just as thick as you please. Hey, that goddamn pan's still hot.
He stuck a burnt knuckle into his mouth. While he'd been complaining, he'd also been using belt knife and fingers to get his portion of supper out of the frying pan. Cardell tossed his slab of kush from hand to hand till it was cool enough to bite. He wolfed it down and licked his fingers when he was through. It wasn't what he would have eaten by choice. It was as far as the moon from the feast Rufus Daniel had been imagining. But cornmeal had a way of sticking to the ribs that made a man forget he was hungry for a while. Dempsey Urey lit a twig at the fire, got his pipe going. Daniel did the same. Cardell lit up a cigar, tilted his head back, and blew a smoke ring at the ceiling. The cabin filled with fragrant smoke.
Glad we're not short of tobacco, anyhow, he said.
Not in this regiment, Urey said.
The 47th drew its men from the heart of North Carolina's tobacco country. Half a dozen soldiers had been tobacconists before the war.
Almost makes me wish I was on picket duty up by the Rapidan, Powell said,
shifting a chaw from one cheek to the other.
Might could be I'd find me a friendly Yank on the other side, trade him some tobacco for coffee and sugar, and maybe some of them little hard candies they have sometimes.
His messmates sighed. That kind of trading went on all the time. Confederates and Federals winked at it.
Why not? Cardell thought. It isn't going to change who wins the war, only make both sides more comfortable.
At the moment, with some food in his belly, a cigar in his hand, and a warm cabin around him, he was comfortable enough. He took another drag.
Picket duty's cold, he said reflectively.
That's true,
a couple of the other sergeants said. Dempsey Urey added,
to hell with your coffee and sugar, Edwin. I ain't gonna freeze to get it.
They talked a while longer and smoked and passed around the new repeater. One by one, they went to bed. The last thing Cardell saw before he fell asleep was Edwin Powell sitting close by the fire, assembling the AK-47 and taking it apart again. Reveille the next morning hit Cardell like an artillery barrage. He threw off his threadbare blanket, scrambled out of bed, and put on his shoes, tunic, and slouch hat. Everyone else was getting dressed at the same time. The hut wasn't really big enough for five men to dress in all at once, but they managed. By now they'd been doing it for 3 months. Dempsey Urey's black felt hat was even more disreputable than Cardell's, but he kept a gaudy turkey feather in the band.
You walk out wearing that bird, somebody'll shoot it off you, Rufus Daniels said.
He cracked the same joke about once a week. Cardell went outside. As always, he had mixed feelings about that first breath of early morning air. It was sweet and fresh and free of most of the smoke that built up inside the cabin, but it was bitterly cold. When he exhaled, he breathed out as big a cloud as if he'd started another cigar. Soldiers came scrambling out of their shelters to line up for morning roll call. In the Federal Army, their appearance would have given apoplexy to any non-commissioned officer worth his stripes. Not all of them had shoes. Their torn trousers were variously blue, Union booty, gray, or butternut. No one wore a blue blouse, for fear of being mistaken for a Yankee troop.
but that was as far as uniformity went there. Some wore forage caps, others slouch hats like Cardell's. The only thing of which that imaginary federal sergeant would have approved was their bearing. The Castilla Invincibles might have been in rags, but they could fight.
"Dress ranks!" Allison High shouted.
The men shifted a little. Company D, as a whole, numbered between 5 and 6 dozen men, which total included 2 corporals, 4 sergeants, First Sergeant Nate Cardell, a couple of lieutenants, and a captain. Right after Gettysburg, sergeants had commanded some companies of the 47th North Carolina. At the moment, the Invincibles were over-supervised. Captain Lewis limped up.
"Call the roll, First Sergeant."
"Yes, sir."
Cardell took from his pocket a much-folded piece of paper. After so many repetitions, he hardly needed to look at it as he called the men's names.
"Bailey, Ransom, Barnes, Lewis D.W., Bass, Gideon."
He finished a few minutes later.
"Winstead, John A., Winstead, William T."
He turned back to Lewis with a salute.
"All present, sir." "Very good. Sick call?"
"Sick call,"
Cardell said loudly. A couple of men took a step forward.
"What's your trouble, Granbury?" he asked one of them. "I got the shits, begging your pardon, First Sergeant. The runs, again,"
Granbury Proctor said. Cardell sighed. With the bad food and bad water the regiment got, diarrhea was a common complaint. This was Proctor's 3rd bout this winter. Cardell said,
"Go see the assistant surgeon, Granbury. Maybe he can do something for you."
Proctor nodded and walked off. Cardell turned to the other sufferer.
"What about you, Southard?"
"Don't rightly know, First Sergeant,"
Bob Southard answered. His voice cracked as he answered. He was only 18 or so. He bent his head and coughed.
"I'm feeling right poorly, though."
Cardell put a skeptical hand on the youngster's forehead. Southard had already deserted the regiment once. He was a shirker.
"No fever. Get back in line."
Dejectedly, the private went back into his slot. The cook banged on his pan. Cardell said,
"Dismiss for breakfast."
Breakfast was cornbread. The meal from which it had been made was ground so coarse that some kernels lay in wait, intact and rock hard, to ambush the teeth. Cardell plucked at his beard to knock crumbs loose. He heard a wagon, no, more than one, rolling down from Orange Courthouse.
"You don't suppose," he said to Rufus Daniel. "This early? Nah,"
Daniel said. But it was. The wagon train turned off the road and rumbled toward the regimental parade ground. Benny Lang rode beside the lead wagon's driver. Slaves accompanied the others. Cardell held out his hand, palm up, to Allison High.
"Pay up." "Hell!"
High reached into his hip pocket, drew out a wad of bills, and gave 2 of them to Cardell.
"Here's your 20. Who'd have thought anybody'd move so quick? Hell!"
He walked off scowling, his head down.
"Easy there, Allison," Cardell called after him. "It's only $20 Confederate, not like before the war when that was a lot of money."
Benny Lang leaped down from his wagon and started shouting like a man possessed.
"Come on, get those crates off! This isn't a bloody picnic, so move it, you lazy Kaffirs!"
The slaves started unloading the wagons at the same steady but leisurely pace they usually used. It was not fast enough to suit Lang.
"Move, damn you!"
he shouted again. The blacks were used to letting such shouts roll off their backs, secure in the knowledge that the work would eventually get done, and the yelling white man would shut up and leave them alone. Lang met that quiet resistance head on. He stamped over to one of the slaves, threw him to the ground with a flip like the one he'd used against Billy Benningfield.
"Ow!" the man cried. "What'd I do, boss?" "Not bloody much,"
Lang snarled, punctuating his words with a kick. The slave cried out again. Lang said scornfully,
You aren't hurt. Now get up and work. And I mean work, damn you. That goes for the rest of you lazy buggers, too, or you'll get worse than I just gave him. Move!
The black men moved. Boxes came down from wagons at an astonishing rate.
Will you look at that? Rufus Daniels said. If I had me enough niggers to hire an overseer, that there Lang would be the first man I'd pick for the job.
Maybe so, Cardell said. But he watched the sidelong glances that were the only safe way the slaves could use to show their resentment.
If he treats them like that all the time, though, he'd better grow eyes on the back of his head, or else he'll have an accident one fine day. Or lots of runaways, anyhow.
Might could be all right, Daniel allowed.
Once the wagons were unloaded, Lang ordered the work crew to carry a share of the crates to each company standard. When the slaves again didn't work fast enough to suit him, he booted one of them in the backside. They moved quicker after that. Lang followed them from company to company. When he came to the Castalia Invincibles, he picked Cardell out by his chevrons, handed him a length of iron with a curved and flattened end.
Here you are first, Sergeant. A ripping bar to get the crates open. We found some of your units had a spot of trouble with that.
You think of everything, Cardell said admiringly.
We do try. You'll have 2 magazines per weapon there, more or less. Enough ammunition to get us started practicing. Your ordnance, Sergeant, needn't fret. We'll get you plenty more as you need it.
With a nod, Lang was off to Company E. Cardell watched him go. After yesterday and this morning, he believed Lang's promise. This was a man who delivered. But then, the Army of Northern Virginia always got the ammunition it needed, one way or another. Cardell wished Benny Lang, or someone like him, would take over the Confederate Commissary Department. The soldiers gathered round the stacked crates.
"Those are repeaters the bad-tempered fellow was showing off to y'all yesterday?" asked Melvin Bean,
a smooth-faced private with a light, clear voice.
"Yep."
Cardell attacked the crate with the bar. The lid came up with a groan of nails, leaving wood. Sure enough, an AK-47 lay inside. Cardell said,
"Anybody with the tools to give me a hand, run and fetch him. We'll get the job done that much quicker."
Tom Short, who worked as a saddler, left and returned shortly with a claw hammer. He fell to work beside Cardell. Before too long, all the Castalia Invincibles held new repeaters. A heavyset private named Ruffin Biggs gave his weapon a dubious look.
"We're supposed to whoop the Yankees with these little things?" "It ain't the size of the dog in the fight, Ruffin," Dempsey Urey drawled. "It's the size of the fight in the dog. These here puppies got plenty of fight in them, believe you me."
Captain Lewis said,
"Break into groups of 6 or 7 men each. That way, everyone who learned about these repeaters yesterday will have one group to teach."
The division, into groups smaller than squads, went rather awkwardly. Eyeing the soldiers in his group, Cardell suspected that the sergeants and corporals, the company's regular squad leaders, had stuck him and the officers with the men they wanted least. He shrugged. Everyone would have to learn. He held up his rifle, pointed to the lever below the charging handle.
"This is the change lever. See, it has 3 positions. For now, I want you to make sure you have it in the topmost one."
"Why's that, First Sergeant?"
Melvin Bean asked.
"Because if you don't, you're liable to end up shooting yourself before you find out how not to," Cardell answered dryly.
That made everyone sit up and take notice. He went through the lesson Lang had given him. The soldiers practiced attaching and removing a magazine. He showed them how rounds were arranged inside the clip and had them practice putting rounds into it. A rifle cracked over in another company. Shouts of alarm rose after the gunshot.
"That's why I want that change lever up top," Cardell said. "As long as it's there, the repeater can't go off by accident. It's called a safety."
Bashal Page, the regimental sergeant major, came up to Captain Lewis and saluted.
"The colonel's compliments, sir, and the companies will practice shooting at our targets one by one in order."
"Very good, Sergeant Major. Thank you," Lewis said.
Page saluted again and marched off, every inch a gentleman.
His blue sergeant's stripes were joined above by an arc that showed he was the most exalted of all the regiment's non-commissioned officers. The lessons went more smoothly than Cardell dared hope. For one thing, Benny Lang had done a good job with his instructions the day before, and Cardell had paid careful attention. For another, despite being different from a rifle musket, the AK-47 was an easy gun to use. Even Ruffin Biggs and Alcee Hopkins, who had not a letter between them, soon got the hang of the repeater. Cardell wondered how they would do when time to clean the weapon came around. He intended to hold off on that till his pupils had fired. The soldiers were learning how to chamber the first round in the banana clip when a volley of shots came from the parade ground. Company A was shooting for the first time. Almost at once, the gunfire rang so thick and fast as to remind Cardell of a whole regiment on the line, not just one understrength company.
"The Chickara guys got new guns. Run for your lives!" Henry Joyner yelled out toward the practicing graycoats.
Like the Castalia Invincibles, the Chickara guards were mostly recruited from Nash County, which made the rivalry between them all the fiercer. For that matter, each company currently boasted three joiners. The relationships between them were too complicated for Cardell to keep straight. One of the soldiers of Company A, maybe one of the joiners, yelled back,
"Shame we ain't got the bullets to waste to turn these here fine new repeaters on you all." "Couldn't hit us if and you did," Henry jeered.
He thumbed his nose.
"Enough,"
Cardell said. Horseplay was fun, but horseplay between men who carried rifles had to be controlled before it got out of hand. Companies B and C, neither of which had a name, took their first turns practicing with the AK-47. The men came away from the firing line exclaiming and shaking their heads in wonder. Some of them slung the new repeaters on their backs. Others carried the carbines in both hands, as if they could not bear to let them go. Three or four men from Company C started a chant.
"Enfield, Springfield, throw 'em in the cornfield!"
Before long, the whole company, officers and all, was singing it. Captain Lewis said,
"Form column of fours, to the parade ground, march!"
A couple of new men just up from North Carolina started off on the wrong foot, but growls from the sergeants soon had them in step with everyone else.
"Shift to the left, from column to fine. Move," Lewis said.
The company performed the evolution with mindless precision bored of unending practice. Cardell remembered the first day of marching down at Camp Mangum, when an irate drill sergeant had compared their ragged line to a drunken centipede in an ass-kicking contest. Even that drill sergeant, assuming he was still alive, would have been satisfied to see them now.
"Load your rifles," Captain Lewis said.
In one motion, the men drew back their charging handles and each chambered around.
"Fire!"
Not every repeater spat flame.
"Check your change lever," Cardell
shouted, along with everyone else, who had had instruction the day before. Soldiers checked. Some of them swore at themselves. The next volley was fuller. In a moment, a fusillade of shots made separate volleys impossible to distinguish. The company's privates shouted in wonder and delight at how rapidly their repeaters fired and how easy they were to shoot. Cardell knew how they felt. The AK-47 was so different from any other rifle that hearing about it wasn't enough. Even after you shot with it, it was hard to believe.
"What happens if you put this here change lever thing on the middle notch?"
Henry Joyner asked.
"If it's as much different from the bottom one as that there one is from the top, reckon this gun'll march out and shoot Yankees all by its lonesome. I'm for it, I'll tell you that."
"Sorry, Henry," Cardell explained about full automatic fire. He also explained about how much ammunition it chewed up, finishing.
"Shooting fast can be bad if you run out of cartridges before the battle's over. That's not easy to do with a rifle musket. With one of these repeaters, especially on full automatic, it's easy as pie. You'll want to be careful about that."
Melvin Bean said,
I got shot in the arm the first day at Gettysburg after I'd used up all my cartridges. Even if I'd seen the damn Yankee who nailed me, I couldn't have done nothing about him."
The new men listened and nodded solemnly. Cardell reflected that a wound on the first day had kept Bean out of the third day's charge, and very possibly kept the private from being captured or killed. Ruffin Biggs fired one more round at the paper target circle, which by now looked as if it were suffering from measles or smallpox. He yelped out a rebel yell, then said,
"Next time the drummers play the long roll, them Yankees is going to wish they was never born. This here rifle shoots like hell-beaten tanbark."
"Is that good?"
Joyner asked.
"Can't be beat,"
Biggs answered positively. "Clear the parade ground," Captain Lewis said. "Time for Company E to have their turn. Form column of fours." Grumbling, disappointed they couldn't shoot more, his men obeyed. Somebody sang out, "Enfield, Springfield, throw 'em in the cornfield!" The chant ran down the column like wildfire. The men from the other companies that had already fired took it up again, too.
"Whole army's going to be singing that before long," Cardell predicted.
"Hope you're right," Dempsey Urey answered. "On account of that'll mean the whole army's got themselves repeaters."
Once they were back by their own shelters, the Castalia Invincibles regrouped around the men Benny Lang had instructed.
"Now for the dull part. Cleaning," Cardell said.
The men groaned. They groaned again when he showed them the cleaning rod and the kit in the stock compartment, and then how to open the receiver plate, an extract spring, bolt carrier, and bolt.
"It's not as bad as it looks," he told them. "They go together like this."
He reassembled the mechanism, closed the cover plate.
"Now you do it."
They tried. The bolt proved reluctant to go back where it was supposed to.
"Maybe for you it goes like this," Melvin Bean said. "For me it just goes straight to the devil."
"Practice," Cardell said smugly. Willingness to practice was a virtue teachers needed. His voice got deeper, more serious.
"You all keep practicing till I see you can do it. Watch me again."
He went through the process very slowly.
"You take another lick at it."
A couple of them succeeded in getting it right. Melvin Bean kept failing and swearing. Cardell walked over, took the private's hands in his, guided them through what had to be done.
"There. Do you see now?"
Bean smiled.
"Reckon so."
This time, everything went smoothly.
"That's a good job," Cardell said, smiling himself. "Anyone else still having trouble?"
Nobody said anything.
"Good. Just don't think that because you did it once, you have it by the tail. Keep working at it tonight. We'll go over it again tomorrow, and the day after that. By then, I want you to be able to take that repeater apart, clean it, and put it back together in your sleep. If you can't, maybe you should be toting a billet of wood instead."
The soldiers' expressions sobered. Carrying a billet was an onerous punishment, but there were better ways to pass a morning. Cardell hesitated before he taught the privates how to clean the magazine spring. Why burden them with something they might not need to know? Benny Lang had said it was only occasionally necessary, and there looked to be plenty of banana clips about. But on second thought, Cardell did demonstrate the technique. What passed for the Confederate supply system could turn plenty into famine without warning.
"More questions?" he said at last. "All right then. Dismissed."
Most of the men drifted away, still talking excitedly about the new repeaters they were carrying. The other groups had already broken up, some a good while before. Cardell cared nothing about that. Thoroughness counted here, and he was used to repeating himself any number of times, until students caught on to what he was saying. Melvin Bean did not wander off. The private removed the receiver plate, took out the rifle's works, tried to put them back together. Cardell watched. They proved bulky. Bean swore softly, then said,
"I just can't make the pesky thing fit. Do you want to come back to my hut with me and show me what I'm doing wrong?"
"I'd be glad to do that," Cardell said. They walked down the straight, muddy lane between rows of shelters. Bean's cabin was small, but neat.
Its one window even boasted shutters. No one else lived here, which was unusual, if not quite unique, in the regiment. Bean opened the door.
"Go right on in, First Sergeant."
Cardell did. The private followed, closing and barring the door between the two of them.
"Now show me that trick of putting this fool rifle back together again."
"You really were having trouble then?"
"I said as much, didn't I? Thought I had it when you showed me before, but I lost the knack again."
They sat together on the blanket-covered pine boughs that did duty for a bed. Bean watched intently as Cardell went through everything.
"So that's what y'all were doing. Here, let me have a go, Nate. I reckon I really have got it now."
Sure enough, the pieces went back together smoothly. "Do it some more. Show me it wasn't a fluke," Cardell said. Bean did, twice running. Cardell nodded. Bean checked to make sure the repeater's change lever was in the safe position, then set the weapons aside.
"Good. I need to be able to do that."
Mischief sparked in the private's eyes.
"And now, Nate Cardell, I expect you'll be looking to find out how your own bolt fits."
"I'd like that a lot." Bean had not waited for him to reply, but was already opening the 7-button private's tunic. Cardell reached out and gently touched one of the small but perfectly feminine breasts that unbuttoning revealed. He smiled. "You know, Molly, if you were one of those bosomy girls, you'd never get by with this."
"If I was, I could bind him up, I suppose," she said seriously. "It'd be as uncomfortable as all get out, though. And I do enough pretending as it is. Melvin. Took me a goodish while even to get used to answering to it."
Cardell's lips followed his fingers. Molly Bean sighed and pulled the tunic off altogether. A long, puckered scar marred the smooth skin of her left upper arm, outer mark of where a mini-ball had gashed the muscle. An inch or two lower, and it would have smashed the bone and cost her the limb.
"Here now," she reached for him. "Ain't hardly fair for me to be the only one getting out of my clothes. Sides, it's chilly in here."
He held her close and did his best to warm her. He certainly forgot about the cold himself, at least until afterwards. When he sat up again, though, he found he was shivering. He dressed quickly. So did Molly. Back in Confederate uniform, with her forage cap pushed down so the brim covered her eyebrows, she seemed just another private, too young to shave. The 47th North Carolina claimed more than a few of those, but she had been all woman in his arms. He studied her as if she were a difficult problem in trigonometry. She was very different from the hard-eyed Richmond whores to whom he'd occasionally resorted when he got leave. He supposed that was because he saw her every day and knew her as a person, not just a convenient receptacle for his lust, to be forgotten as soon as he was out the door. "Ask you something?" he said. She shrugged.
"Go ahead. How come you did this?" "You mean, how come I came up to the fighting?" she said.
He nodded. She shrugged again.
"I was bored down home. Wasn't hardly nobody coming by the body house where I was at either. What with so many men being away to the war. Guess I figured I'd come up and see it for myself, see what it was like."
"And?" Her face twisted into a wry grin. She still wasn't pretty in any conventional sense of the word, especially with her black hair clipped off short like a man's. But her wide, full-lipped smile made her seem much more feminine when she smiled. She said,
"Didn't like getting shot worth a damn, I'll tell you that, Nate."
"I believe you." He thanked his lucky stars he was still unwounded. Few bullets were as merciful as the one that had found her. The ghastly piles of arms and legs outside the surgeon's tent after every fight. The screams of men shot in the belly. The dying gurgles of men shot through the chest. He was glad to forget those images when she went on.
"But for that, though, y'all and the company are more like family than anything I ever knew before I got here. Y'all take care about me, like you was my brothers. And y'all keep the officers from finding out what I am."
Her wry grin flashed again.
'cause you know blamed well I ain't your sister."
He laughed at that. He'd never asked before, though she'd been with the regiment a year. He didn't know what he'd expected to hear. Perhaps something more melodramatic than her plain story. He took out the $20 Confederate he'd won from Allison High, gave the bills to her.
"Wish it was federal greenbacks," she said. "But it'll do, Nate. It'll do. Want to go another round?"
He thought about it, but shook his head.
"I'd better not. I can't afford the time.
I've been away too long as is."
"You care about what you're doing. That's a good thing."
Molly made a face at him.
"Or is it just I'm getting old? Can't think of many who would have turned me down if I'd asked them when I was down in Rivington."
"You're a damn sight younger than I am. You..." Cardell stopped. "You were in Rivington before you joined up? They see these new repeaters come from there. And the people who make them or sell them, or whatever it is they do."
"I've heard that too," Molly said.
Cardell reflected that she'd probably heard it well before he did. She usually got news even before Colonel Faribault heard it. She went on.
"Don't know nothing about it, though. Them fellas went there when I left the place a year ago. Not much else was, neither. Especially not men, so I got out. Sure you don't want to go again?"
"What I want to do and what I have to do are two different things," Cardell said. "This is the army, remember?" Her laugh followed him as he returned to the cold and military world outside her cabin door. He looked down the lane toward the parade ground. George Hines was out there on his hands and knees, gathering up brass cartridge cases. 3. The locomotive snorted and hissed as it slowed. The shriek of the locked driving wheels against sanded rails reminded General Lee of the cries of wounded horses, the most piteous sound on any battlefield. The train stopped. There was a last jolt as the cars came together with a clanking clatter of link and pin couplings. Lee and the other passengers got to their feet.
"All out to Richmond," the conductor called before hurrying down to the next car to repeat the cry.
Carpet bag in hand, Lee descended to the muddy ground outside the Virginia Central Railroad Depot, at the corner of 16th and Broad. The depot was a plain wooden shed, much in need of paint. A banner on the door of the tavern across the street advertised fried oysters at half price, in honor of George Washington's birthday. The banner made Lee pause in mild bemusement. Strange how the Confederacy still revered the founding fathers of the United States. Or perhaps it was not so strange. Surely Washington, were he somehow to whirl through time to the present, would find himself more at home on a southern plantation than in a brawling northern factory town like Pittsburgh or New York. And of course Washington was a Virginian. So where better to celebrate his birthday than Richmond? A young man's brisk voice brought Lee out of his reverie and back to the here and now.
"General, I have a carriage waiting for you, sir."
He turned around, exchanged salutes with a lieutenant who wore a uniform nattier than any still to be found in the Army of Northern Virginia.
"I hope you are not waiting long for me."
"No, sir."
The lieutenant pulled out a pocket watch.
"It's but a few minutes after 4. The train was due in at 3:15. I arrived then, on the off chance it might be on time."
Both men smiled, knowing how unlikely that was. But a wise lieutenant did not take chances, not when he was meeting the senior officer of his army. He held out his hand for Lee's bag.
"If you'll come with me, sir."
Lee followed him to the carriage. Its black driver tapped a finger against the brim of his tall silk hat as Lee got in.
"Evening, Mars Robert."
"Hello, Luke.
How are you today?" "Oh, middling, sir. I expect I'm about middling." "That's a fair enough place to be," Lee said judiciously.
The lieutenant put a snap of command in his voice. "Back to the president's office, Luke."
"Yes, sir."
Luke flicked his whip. The two horse teams started northwest up Broad Street. Like the lieutenant, both animals were in finer fettle than the beasts Jeb Stuart's troopers rode. It was the same in Washington City, Lee had heard. He believed it.
The farther one drew from the front lines, the easier one found comfort. Train tracks ran down the middle of Broad Street, connecting the Virginia Central Depot with that of the Richmond, Fredericksburg, and Potomac, 8 blocks away. Lee heard an engine coming their way, puffing at full throttle, to haul a fully laden train up steep Shaco Hill. The horses heard, too, and tossed their heads to show they did not approve. Luke calmed them with a few soft words. Before the bellowing, cinder-belching monster appeared, the carriage turned left onto 12th Street. It rattled through Capitol Square on the way to the new building that had been the Custom House before Virginia left the Union. Off to the left, twin rows of oaks led to the governor's mansion. To the right, Lee got a quick glimpse of the equestrian statue of George Washington before it vanished behind the severely classic bulk of the Virginia State Capitol, now also the home of the Confederate Congress. The white columns and walls were remarkably handsome in spring and summer, when set against the rich green of the lawns and shrubbery and trees that surrounded them. Now the lawns were dead and yellow, the trees skeletal, without their cloak of leaves. The Confederate flag waved bravely over the Capitol, red canton with blue saltier cross and 13 stars on a white ground. The stainless banner would come down soon. Sunset was near. It was both like enough to the Stars and Stripes, and different enough from it to stir conflicting feelings in Lee. He remembered the day, almost 3 years gone now, when he had gone into the House of Delegates to take charge of Virginia's forces. He shook his head. 4 days before that, Winfield Scott had offered him command over the armies of the United States to lead them against their seceded brethren. He still thought he had made the right, for him the only, choice. The massive rectangle of the former Custom House took up a whole city block. Built from concrete and steel, it might have served duty as a fortress. Unlike most of Richmond's major buildings, it was in Italianate rather than neoclassic style. Its 3 stories shone by the tall windows with arched tops. Luke hitched his team to the rail in front of the building. The lieutenant said,
"You'll be at your disposal for the length of your stay in the city, sir. Now I will take you to President Davis. Let me have your bag there, if you would."
"That's very kind of you, sir."
Lee followed the lieutenant inside. The first floor housed the Treasury Department. Most of the time, busy men there would pause to look and point as Lee walked to the stairs. Those men needed to be busy, he thought, with less than perfect forbearance, to print all the paper money that was pushing prices in the Confederacy to the sky. But even they had Washington's birthday as a holiday. The second floor was always quiet, today no more so than usual. That floor belonged to the Department of State. No foreign nation had recognized the Confederate States of America, nor did any seem likely to, unless the South won more victories than she had thus far. President Davis's offices were on the third floor. The lieutenant tapped on a closed door.
"Yes?" Jefferson Davis called from within. "I have General Lee with me, sir." "Excellent. I will see him. You may return to your other duties."
The lieutenant opened the door, saluted Lee one last time, and hurried away.
"Mr. President," Lee said. "Come right in, General. I'll be with you directly."
Davis was going around with a tallow dip, lighting lamps. His bearing was military, indeed extraordinarily erect. He was a West Point man himself, from the class a year ahead of Lee's. He came back to his desk last and lit 2 lamps there.
"Go on, sit down. Make yourself comfortable." "Thank you, sir."
Lee waited for Davis to seat himself before he sank into an overstuffed armchair. The lamplight played up the hollows in Davis's gaunt cheeks, lit his pale eyes within the shadow.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.